Chapter 31 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or the Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 31, Boys and Girls. By the time the boys reached the village of Voorhout, which stands near the Grand Canal about halfway between The Hague and Haarlem, they were forced to hold a council. The wind, though moderate at first, had grown stronger and stronger, until at last they could hardly skate against it. The weather vanes throughout the country had evidently entered into a conspiracy.
"No use trying to face such a blow as this," said Ludwig. "It cuts its way down a man's throat like a knife."
"Keep your mouth shut, then," grunted the affable Karl, who was as strong-chested as a young ox. "I'm for keeping on."
"In this case," interposed Peter, "we must consult the weakest of the party rather than the strongest." The captain's principle was all right, but its application was not flattering to Master Ludwig. Shrugging his shoulders, he retorted,
"Who's weak? Not I, for one. But the wind's stronger than any of us. I hope you'll condescend to admit that."
"Ha, ha!" laughed von Monen, who could barely keep his feet. "So it is."
Just then the weather vanes telegraphed to each other by a peculiar twitch, and in an instant the gust came. It nearly threw the strong-chested Karl. It almost strangled Jacob, and quite upset Ludwig.
"This settles the question," shouted Peter. "Off with your skates. We'll go into Voorhout."
At Voorhout they found a little inn with a big yard. The yard was well stocked, and better than all, was provided with a complete set of skittles, so our boys soon turned the detention into a frolic. The wind was troublesome again even in that sheltered quarter, but they were on good standing ground and did not mind it. First a hearty dinner, then the game. With pins as long as their arms and balls as big as their heads, plenty of strength left for rolling, and a clean sweep of 60 yards for the strokes, no wonder they were happy. That night Captain Peter and his men slept soundly. No prowling robber came to disturb them, and as they were distributed in separate rooms, they did not even have a bolster battle in the morning. Such a breakfast as they ate! The landlord looked frightened. When he had asked them where they belonged, he made up his mind that the Brook people starved their children. It was a shame. Such fine young gentlemen, too! Fortunately, the wind had tired itself out and fallen asleep in the great sea cradle beyond the dunes. There were signs of snow, otherwise the weather was fine. It was mere child's play for the well-rested boys to skate to Leyden. Here they halted a while, for Peter had an errand at the Golden Eagle. He left the city with a lightened heart. Dr. Bookman had been at the hotel, read the note containing Hans's message, and departed for Brook.
"I cannot say that it was your letter that sent him off so soon," explained the landlord. "Some rich lady in Brook was taken bad very sudden, and he was sent for in haste."
Peter turned pale.
"What was the name?" he asked.
"Indeed, it went in one ear and out of the other, for all I hindered it. Plague on people who can't see a traveller in comfortable lodgings, but they must whisk him off before one can breathe."
"A lady in Brook, did you say?"
"Yes," very gruffly. "Any other business, young master?"
"No, mine host, except that I and my comrades here would like a bite of something and a drink of hot coffee."
"Ah," said the landlord sweetly. "A bite you shall have, and coffee too, the finest in Leyden. Walk up to the stove, my masters. Now I think again. That was a widow lady from Rotterdam, I think they said, visiting at one von Stoepel's, if I mistake not."
"Ah," said Peter, greatly relieved. "They live in the White House by the Schlossen Mill. Now, mynheer, the coffee, please."
What a goose I was, thought he, as the party left the Golden Eagle, to feel so sure that it was my mother. But she may be somebody's mother, poor woman, for all that. Who can she be, I wonder?
There were not many upon the canal that day between Leyden and Haarlem. However, as the boys neared Amsterdam, they found themselves once more in the midst of a moving throng. The big Ijsbreker, an icebreaker, a heavy machine armed with iron spikes for breaking the ice as it is dragged along. Some of the small ones are worked by men, but the large ones are drawn by horses, 60 or 70 of which are sometimes attached to one Ijsbreker. The big Ijsbreker had been at work for the first time that season, but there was any amount of skating ground left yet. "Three cheers for home!" cried Van Monen as they came in sight of the great western dock, Vastelijk Dok. "Hurrah! Hurrah!" shouted one and all. "Hurrah! Hurrah!" This trick of cheering was an importation among our party. Lambert van Monen had brought it from England. As they always gave it in English, it was considered quite an exploit, and when circumstances permitted, always enthusiastically performed, to the sore dismay of their quiet-loving countrymen. Therefore, their arrival at Amsterdam created a great sensation, especially among the small boys on the wharf. The Ijs was crossed. They were on the Brook Canal. Lambert's home was reached first. "Goodbye, boys," he cried as he left them. "We've had the greatest frolic ever known in Holland." "So we have. Goodbye, Van Monen," answered the boys. "Goodbye," Peter hailed him. "I say, Van Monen, the classes begin tomorrow." "I know it. Our holiday is over. Goodbye again." "Goodbye." Brooke came in sight. Such meetings! Katrinka was upon the canal. Karl was delighted. Hilda was there. Peter felt rested in an instant. Richie was there. Ludwig and Jacob nearly knocked each other over in their eagerness to shake hands with her. Dutch girls are modest and generally quiet, but they have very glad eyes. For a few moments it was hard to decide whether Hilda, Richie, or Katrinka felt the most happy. Annie Bowman was also on the canal, looking even prettier than the other maidens in her graceful peasant's costume. But she did not mingle with Richie's party, neither did she look unusually happy. The one she liked most to see was not among the newcomers. Indeed, he was not upon the canal at all. She had not been near Brook before, since the eve of St. Nicholas, for she was staying with her sick grandmother in Amsterdam and had been granted a brief resting spell, as the grandmother called it, because she had been such a faithful little nurse night and day. Annie had devoted her resting spell to skating with all her might toward Brook and back again, in the hope of meeting her mother on the canal, or, it might be, Gretel Brinker. Not one of them had she seen, and she must hurry back even without catching a glimpse of her mother's cottage, for the poor helpless grandmother, she knew, was by this time moaning for someone to turn her upon her cot. "Where can Gretel be?" thought Annie as she flew over the ice. "She can almost always steal a few moments from her work at this time of day. Poor Gretel! What a dreadful thing it must be to have a dull father! I should be woefully afraid of him, I know, so strong and yet so strange." Annie had not heard of his illness. Dame Brinker and her affairs received but little notice from the people of the place. If Gretel had not been known as a goose-girl, she might have had more friends among the peasantry of the neighborhood. As it was, Annie Bowman was the only one who did not feel ashamed to avow herself, by word and deed, the companion of Gretel and Hans. When the neighbors' children laughed at her for keeping such poor company, she would simply flush when Hans was ridiculed, or laugh in a careless, disdainful way, but to hear little Gretel abused always awakened her wrath. "Goose girl, indeed," she would say. "I can tell you that any of you are fitter for the work than she. My father often said last summer that it troubled him to see such a bright-eyed, patient little maiden tending geese. She would not harm them as you would, Jansum Kolp, and she would not tread upon them as you might, Kate Voeders." This would be pretty sure to start a laugh at the clumsy, ill-natured Kate's expense, and Annie would walk loftily away from the group of young gossips. Perhaps some memory of Gretel's assailants crossed her mind as she skated rapidly toward Amsterdam, for her eyes sparkled ominously, and she more than once gave her pretty head a defiant toss. When that mood passed, such a bright, rosy, affectionate look illuminated her face that more than one weary working man turned to gaze after her and to wish that he had a glad, contented lass like that for a daughter. There were 5 joyous households in Brook that night. The boys were back safe and sound, and they found all well at home. Even the sick lady at neighbor Van Stupel's was out of danger. But the next morning, ah, how stupidly school bells will ding-dong, ding-dong, when one is tired. Ludwig was sure that he had never listened to anything so odious. Even Peter felt pathetic on the occasion. Karl said it was a shameful thing for a fellow to have to turn out when his bones were splitting. And Jacob soberly bade Ben "Goodbye," and walked off with his satchel as if it weighed 100 pounds. End of chapter. Chapter 32 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 32, The Crisis. While the boys are nursing their fatigue, we will take a peep into the Brinker cottage. Can it be that Gretel and her mother have not stirred since we saw them last? That the sick man upon the bed is not even turned over? It was 4 days ago, and there is the sad group just as it was before. No, not precisely the same, for Ralph Brinker is paler. His fever is gone, though he knows nothing of what is passing. Then they were alone in the bare, clean room. Now there is another group in an opposite corner. Dr. Bookman is there, talking in a low tone with a stout young man who listens intently. The stout young man is his student and assistant. Hans is there also. He stands near the window, respectfully waiting until he shall be accosted.
"You see, Vollenhoven," said Dr. Bookman, "it is a clear case of..."
And here the doctor went off into a queer jumble of Latin and Dutch that I cannot conveniently translate. After a while, as Vollenhoven looked at him rather blankly, the learned man condescended to speak to him in simpler phrase.
"It is probably like Rip Donderdunk's case," he exclaimed in a low, mumbling tone. "He fell from the top of Voppelblut's windmill. After the accident, the man was stupid and finally became idiotic. In time he lay helpless like yon fellow on the bed, moaned, too, like him, and kept constantly lifting his hand to his head. My learned friend Van Chopin performed an operation upon this Donderdunk, and discovered under the skull a small, dark sack which pressed upon the brain. This had been the cause of the trouble. My friend Van Chopin removed it, a splendid operation. You see, according to Celsius..." And here the doctor again went off into Latin.
"Did the man live?" asked the assistant respectfully. Dr. Bookman scowled.
"That is of no consequence. I believe he died, but why not fix your mind on the grand features of the case? Consider a moment how..." And he plunged into Latin mysteries more deeply than ever.
"But, mynheer," gently persisted the student, who knew that the doctor would not rise to the surface for hours unless pulled at once from his favorite depths. "Mynheer, you have other engagements today. 3 legs in Amsterdam, you remember, and an eye in Brook, and that tumor up the canal."
"The tumor can wait," said the doctor reflectively. "That is another beautiful case, a beautiful case. The woman has not lifted her head from her shoulder for 2 months. Magnificent tumor, sir."
The doctor by this time was speaking aloud. He had quite forgotten where he was. Vollenhoven made another attempt.
"This poor fellow on the bed, mynheer, do you think you can save him?"
"Ah, indeed, certainly," stammered the doctor, suddenly perceiving that he had been talking rather off the point. "Certainly, that is, I hope so."
"If anyone in Holland can, mynheer," murmured the assistant with honest bluntness, "it is yourself."
The doctor looked displeased, growled out a tender request for the student to talk less, and beckoned Hans to draw near. This strange man had a great horror of speaking to women, especially on surgical matters. "One can never tell," he said, "what moment the creatures will scream or faint." Therefore he explained Raff Brinker's case to Hans, and told him what he believed should be done to save the patient. Hans listened attentively, growing red and pale by turns, and throwing quick, anxious glances toward the bed.
"It may kill the father, did you say, mynheer?" he exclaimed at last in a trembling whisper.
"It may, my boy, but I have a strong belief that it will cure and not kill. Ah, if boys were not such dunces, I could lay the whole matter before you, but it would be of no use."
Hans looked blank at this compliment.
"It would be of no use," repeated Dr. Bookman indignantly. "A great operation is proposed, but one might as well do it with a hatchet. The only question asked is, will it kill?"
"The question is everything to us, mynheer," said Hans with tearful dignity.
Dr. Bookman looked at him in sudden dismay. "Ah, exactly so. You're right, boy. I am a fool. Good boy. One does not wish one's father killed. Of course, I am a fool."
"Will he die, mynheer, if this sickness goes on?"
"Huh. This is no new illness. The same thing growing worse every instant. Pressure on the brain. Will take him off soon like that," said the doctor, snapping his fingers.
"And the operation may save him," pursued Hans. "How soon, mynheer, can we know?"
Dr. Bookman grew impatient. "In a day, perhaps an hour. Talk with your mother, boy, and let her decide. My time is short."
Hans approached his mother. At first, when she looked up at him, he could not utter a syllable. Then, turning his eyes away, he said in a firm voice, "I must speak with the mother alone." Quick little Gretel, who could not quite understand what was passing, threw rather an indignant look at Hans and walked away.
"Come back, Gretel, and sit down," said Hans sorrowfully. She obeyed. Dame Brinker and her boy stood by the window while the doctor and his assistant, bending over the bedside, conversed together in a low tone. There was no danger of disturbing the patient. He appeared like one blind and deaf. Only his faint, piteous moans showed him to be a living man. Hans was talking earnestly, and in a low voice, for he did not wish his sister to hear. With dry, parted lips, Dame Brinker leaned toward him, searching his face, as if suspecting a meaning beyond his words. Once she gave a quick, frightened sob that made Gretel start, but after that she listened calmly. When Hans ceased to speak, his mother turned, gave one long, agonized look at her husband, lying there so pale and unconscious, and threw herself on her knees beside the bed. Poor little Gretel! What did all this mean? She looked with questioning eyes at Hans. He was standing, but his head was bent as if in prayer, at the doctor. He was gently feeling her father's head, and looked like one examining some curious stone, at the assistant. The man coughed and turned away. At her mother. Ah, little Gretel, that was the best you could do, to kneel beside her and twine your warm young arms about her neck, to weep and implore God to listen. When the mother arose, Dr. Bookman, with a show of trouble in his eyes, asked gruffly,
"Well, Juffrouw, shall it be done?"
"Will it pain him, mynheer?"
she asked in a trembling voice. "I cannot say. Probably not. Shall it be done?"
"It may cure him," you said. "And, Mynheer, did you tell my boy that perhaps...
She could not finish. "Yes, Juffrouw, I said the patient might sink under the operation, but we hope it may prove otherwise." He looked at his watch. The assistant moved impatiently toward the window. "Come, Juffrouw, time presses. Yes or no?"
Hans wound his arm about his mother. It was not his usual way. He even leaned his head against her shoulder. "The Meester awaits an answer," he whispered. Dame Brinker had long been head of her house in every sense. Many a time she had been very stern with Hans, ruling him with a strong hand and rejoicing in her motherly discipline. Now she felt so weak, so helpless. It was something to feel that firm embrace. There was strength even in the touch of that yellow hair. She turned to her boy imploringly. "Oh, Hans, what shall I say?"
"Say what God tells thee, mother," answered Hans, bowing his head. One quick questioning prayer to heaven rose from the mother's heart. The answer came. She turned toward Dr. Buchmann.
"It is right, mynheer. I consent."
"Humph," grunted the doctor, as if to say, "You've been long enough about it."
Then he conferred a moment with his assistant, who listened with great outward deference but was inwardly rejoicing at the grand joke he would have to tell his fellow students. He had actually seen a tear in old Buchmann's eye. Meanwhile Gretel looked on in trembling silence, but when she saw the doctor open a leather case and take out one sharp, gleaming instrument after another, she sprang forward.
"Oh, mother, the poor father meant no wrong. Are they going to murder him?"
"I do not know, child,"
screamed Dame Brinker, looking fiercely at Gretel.
"I do not know."
"This will not do, Juffrouw," said Dr. Buchmann sternly, and at the same time he cast a quick, penetrating look at Hans. "You and the girl must leave the room. The boy may stay."
Dame Brinker drew herself up in an instant. Her eyes flashed. Her whole countenance was changed. She looked like one who had never wept, never felt a moment's weakness. Her voice was low, but decided.
"I stay with my husband, mynheer."
Dr. Buchmann looked astonished. His orders were seldom disregarded in this style. For an instant his eyes met hers.
"You may remain, Juffrouw," he said in an altered voice. Gretel had already disappeared. In one corner of the cottage was a small closet where her rough, box-like bed was fastened against the wall. None would think of the trembling little creature crouching there in the dark. Dr. Buchmann took off his heavy coat, filled an earthen basin with water, and placed it near the bed. Then, turning to Hans, he asked,
"Can I depend upon you, boy?"
"You can, mynheer."
"I believe you. Stand at the head, here. Your mother may sit at your right. So." And he placed a chair near the cot. "Remember, Juffrouw, there must be no cries, no fainting."
Dame Brinker answered him with a look. He was satisfied.
"Now, Vollenhoven."
"Oh, that case with the terrible instruments." The assistant lifted them. Gretel, who had been peering with brimming eyes through the crack of the closet door, could remain silent no longer. She rushed frantically across the apartment, seized her hood, and ran from the cottage. End of chapter.
Chapter 33 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates,
by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 33. Gretel and Hilda. It was recess hour. At the first stroke of the schoolhouse bell, the canal seemed to give a tremendous shout and grow suddenly alive with boys and girls. Dozens of gaily clad children were skating in and out among each other, and all their pent-up merriment of the morning was relieving itself in song and shout and laughter. There was nothing to check the flow of frolic. Not a thought of schoolbooks came out with them into the sunshine. Latin, arithmetic, grammar, all were locked up for an hour in the dingy schoolroom. The teacher might be a noun if he wished, and a proper one at that, but they meant to enjoy themselves. As long as the skating was as perfect as this, it made no difference whether Holland was on the North Pole or the equator. And as for philosophy, how could they bother themselves with inertia and gravitation and such things when it was as much as they could do to keep from getting knocked over in the commotion? In the height of the fun, one of the children called out, "What is that?" "What? Where?" cried a dozen voices. "Why, don't you see? That dark thing over there by the idiot's cottage." "I don't see anything," said one.
"I do," shouted another. "It's a dog."
"Where's any dog?"
put in a squeaky voice that we have heard before.
"It's no such thing. It's a heap of rags."
"Pooh, voost," retorted another gruffly. "That's about as near the fact as you ever get. It's the goose girl, Gretel, looking for rats."
"Well, what of it?" squeaked Voost. "Isn't she a bundle of rags, I'd like to know?"
"Ha, ha, ha! Pretty good for you, Voost. You'll get a medal for wit yet, if you keep on."
"You'd get something else if your brother Hans were here. I'll warrant you would,"
said a muffled-up little fellow with a cold in his head. As Hans was not there, Voost could afford to scout the insinuation.
"Who cares for him, little sneezer? I'd fight a dozen like him any day, and you in the bargain."
"You would you? I'd like to catch you all at it."
And by the way of proving his words, the sneezer skated off at the top of his speed. Just then a general chase after three of the biggest boys of the school was proposed, and friend and foe, frolicsome as ever, were soon united in a common cause. Only one of all that happy throng remembered the dark little form by the idiot's cottage. Poor, frightened little Gretel. She was not thinking of them, though their merry laughter floated lightly toward her, making her feel like one in a dream. How low the moans were behind the darkened window! What if those strange men were really killing her father? The thought made her spring to her feet with a cry of horror.
"Ah, no!"
she sobbed, sinking upon the frozen mound of earth where she had been sitting. "Mother is there, and Hans. They will care for him." But how pale they were! And even Hans was crying. "Why did the cross old maester keep him and send me away?" she thought. "I could have clung to the mother and kissed her. That always makes her stroke my hair and speak gently, even after she has scolded me. How quiet it is now! Oh, if the father should die, and Hans and the mother, what would I do?" And Gretel, shivering with cold, buried her face in her arms and cried as if her heart would break. The poor child had been tasked beyond her strength during the past 4 days. Through all, she had been her mother's willing little handmaiden, soothing, helping, and cheering the half-widowed woman by day, and watching and praying beside her all the long night. She knew that something terrible and mysterious was taking place at this moment, something that had been too terrible and mysterious for even kind, good Hans to tell. Then new thoughts came. Why had not Hans told her? It was a shame. It was her father as well as his. She was no baby. She had once taken a sharp knife from the father's hand. She had even drawn him away from the mother on that awful night when Hans, as big as he was, could not help her. Why, then, must she be treated like one who could do nothing? Oh, how very still it was! How bitter, bitter cold!
If any bowman had only stayed home instead of going to Amsterdam, it wouldn't be so lonely. How cold her feet were growing! Was it the moaning that made her feel as if she were floating in the air? This would not do. The mother might need her help at any moment. Rousing herself with an effort, Gretel sat upright, rubbing her eyes and wondering, wondering that the sky was so bright and blue, wondering at the stillness in the cottage, more than all, at the laughter rising and falling in the distance. Soon she sank down again, the strange medley of thought growing more and more confused in her bewildered brain. What a strange lip the maester had! How the stork's nest upon the roof seemed to rustle and whisper down to her! How bright those knives were in the leather case, brighter perhaps than the silver skates! If she had but worn her new jacket, she would not shiver so. The new jacket was pretty, the only pretty thing she had ever worn. God had taken care of her father so long. He would do it still, if those two men would but go away. Ah, now the maesters were on the roof. They were clambering to the top. No, it was her mother and Hans. Or the storks. It was so dark, who could tell? And the mound rocking, swinging in that strange way. How sweetly the birds were singing. They must be winter birds, for the air was thick with icicles. Not one bird, but 20. Oh, hear them, mother. Wake me, mother, for the race. I am so tired with crying and crying. A firm hand was laid upon her shoulder. Get up, little girl, cried a kind voice. This will not do for you to lie here and freeze. Gretel slowly raised her head. She was so sleepy that it seemed nothing strange to her that Hilda von Gleck should be leaning over her, looking with kind, beautiful eyes into her face. She had often dreamed it before. But she had never dreamed that Hilda was shaking her roughly, almost dragging her by main force, never dreamed that she heard her saying, "Gretel, Gretel Brinker, you must wake!" This was real. Gretel looked up. Still the lovely, delicate young lady was shaking, rubbing, fairly pounding her. It must be a dream. No, there was the cottage, and the stork's nest, and the maester's coach by the canal. She could see them now quite plainly. Her hands were tingling, her feet throbbing. Hilda was forcing her to walk. At last Gretel began to feel like herself again.
"I have been asleep," she faltered,
rubbing her eyes with both hands and looking very much ashamed.
"Yes, indeed, entirely too much asleep," laughed Hilda, whose lips were very pale. "But you are well enough now. Lean upon me, Gretel. There, keep moving. You will soon be warm enough to go by the fire. Now let me take you into the cottage."
"Oh, no, 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 Jufvrouw, not in there. The maester is there. He sent me away."
Hilda was puzzled, but she wisely forbore to ask at present for an explanation.
"Very well, Gretel, try to walk faster. I saw you upon the mound some time ago, but I thought you were playing." "That is right. Keep moving."
All this time the kind-hearted girl had been forcing Gretel to walk up and down, supporting her with one arm and, with the other, striving as well as she could to take off her own warm jacket. Suddenly Gretel suspected her intention.
"Oh, Jufvrouw, Jufvrouw," she cried imploringly, "please never think of such a thing as that. Oh, please keep it on. I am burning all over, Jufvrouw. I really am burning. Not burning exactly, but pins and needles pricking all over me. Oh, Jufvrouw, don't."
The poor child's dismay was so genuine that Hilda hastened to reassure her.
"Very well, Gretel, move your arms then. So. Why, your cheeks are as pink as roses already. I think the maester would let you in now. He certainly would. Is your father so very ill?"
"Ah, Jufvrouw," cried Gretel, weeping afresh, "he is dying, I think."
There are two maesters in with him at this moment, and the mother has scarcely spoken today. Can you hear him moan, Jufvrouw?" she added with sudden terror. "The air buzzes so I cannot hear. He may be dead. Oh, I do wish I could hear him."
Hilda listened. The cottage was very near, but not a sound could be heard. Something told her that Gretel was right. She ran to the window.
"You cannot see there, my lady," sobbed Gretel eagerly. "The mother has oiled paper hanging inside, but at the other one, in the south end of the cottage, you can look in where the paper is torn."
Hilda, in her anxiety, ran around, past the corner where the low roof was fringed with its loosened thatch. A sudden thought checked her. "It is not right for me to peep into another's house in this way," she said to herself. Then, softly calling to Gretel, she added in a whisper, "You may look. Perhaps he is only sleeping." Gretel tried to walk briskly toward the spot, but her limbs were trembling. Hilda hastened to her support. "You are sick yourself, I fear," she said kindly.
"No, not sick, Jufvrouw, but my heart cries all the time now, even when my eyes are as dry as yours." "Why, Jufvrouw, your eyes are not dry. Are you crying for us? Oh, Jufvrouw, if God sees you! Oh, I know father will get better now."
And the little creature, even while reaching to look through the tiny window, kissed Hilda's hand again and again. The sash was sadly patched and broken. A torn piece of paper hung halfway down across it. Gretel's face was pressed to the window.
"Can you see anything?"
whispered Hilda at last.
"Yes. The father lies very still. His head is bandaged, and all their eyes are fastened upon him." "Oh, Jufvrouw!"
almost screamed Gretel, as she started back, and by a quick, dexterous movement shook off her heavy wooden shoes.
"I must go in to my mother. Will you come with me?"
"Not now. The bell is ringing. I shall come again soon. Good-bye."
Gretel scarcely heard the words. She remembered for many a day afterward the bright, pitying smile on Hilda's face as she turned away. End of chapter. Chapter 34 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 34, The Awakening. An angel could not have entered the cottage more noiselessly. Gretel, not daring to look at anyone, slid softly to her mother's side. The room was very still. She could hear the old doctor breathe. She could almost hear the sparks as they fell into the ashes on the hearth. The mother's hand was very cold, but a burning spot glowed on her cheek, and her eyes were like a deer's, so bright, so sad, so eager. At last there was a movement upon the bed, very slight, but enough to cause them all to start. Dr. Bookman leaned eagerly forward. Another movement. The large hands, so white and soft for a poor man's hand, twitched, then raised itself steadily toward the forehead. It felt the bandage, not in a restless, crazy way, but with a questioning movement that caused even Dr. Bookman to hold his breath.
"Steady, steady," said a voice that sounded very strange to Gretel. "Shift that mat higher, boys. Now throw on the clay. The waters are rising fast. No time to—"
Dame Brinker sprang forward like a young panther. She seized his hands, and leaning over him cried,
"Raff, Raff, boy, speak to me!"
"Is it you, Major?" he asked faintly. "I have been asleep. Hurt, I think. Where is little Hans?"
"Here I am, father,"
shouted Hans, half mad with joy, but the doctor held him back.
"He knows us," screamed Dame Brinker. "Great God, he knows us! Gretel, Gretel, come see your father."
In vain Dr. Bookman commanded, "Silence," and tried to force them from the bedside. He could not keep them off. Hans and the mother laughed and cried together as they hung over the newly awakened man. Gretel made no sound but gazed at them all with glad, startled eyes. Her father was speaking in a faint voice.
"Is the baby asleep, Major?"
"The baby!"
echoed Dame Brinker.
"Oh, Gretel, that is you! And he calls Hans little Hans! 10 years asleep! Oh, Mynheer, you have saved us all! He has known nothing for 10 years! Children, why don't you thank the Meister?"
The good woman was beside herself with joy. Dr. Bookman said nothing, but as his eye met hers, he pointed upward. She understood. So did Hans and Gretel. With one accord they knelt by the cot, side by side. Dame Brinker felt for her husband's hand even while she was praying. Dr. Bookman's head was bowed. The assistant stood by the hearth with his back toward them.
"Why do you pray?"
murmured the father, looking feebly from the bed as they rose.
"Is it God's day?"
It was not Sunday, but his brow bowed her head. She could not speak.
"Then we should have a chapter,"
said Ralph Brinker, speaking slowly and with difficulty.
"I do not know how it is. I am very, very weak. Mayhap the minister will read it to us."
Gretel lifted the big Dutch Bible from its carved shelf. Dr. Bookman, rather dismayed at being called a minister, coughed and handed the volume to his assistant. "Read," he murmured. "These people must be kept quiet, or the man will die yet." When the chapter was finished, Dame Brinker motioned mysteriously to the rest by way of telling them that her husband was asleep.
"Now, Juffrouw," said the doctor in a subdued tone as he drew on his thick woolen mittens, "there must be perfect quiet. You understand, this is truly a most remarkable case. I shall come again tomorrow. Give the patient no food today." And, bowing hastily, he left the cottage, followed by his assistant. His grand coach was not far away. The driver had kept the horses moving slowly up and down by the canal nearly all the time the doctor had been in the cottage. Hans went out also.
"May God bless you, Mynheer," he said, blushing and trembling. "I can never repay you, but if—"
"Yes, you can," interrupted the doctor crossly. "You can use your wits when the patient wakes again. This clacking and sniveling is enough to kill a well man, let alone one lying on the edge of his grave. If you want your father to get well, keep him quiet."
So saying, Dr. Bookman, without another word, stalked off to meet his coach, leaving Hans standing there with eyes and mouth wide open. Hilda was reprimanded severely that day for returning late to school after recess and for imperfect recitations. She had remained near the cottage until she heard Dame Brinker laugh, until she had heard Hans say,
"Here I am, father!"
And then she had gone back to her lessons. What wonder that she missed them! How could she get a long string of Latin verbs by heart when her heart did not care a fig for them, but would keep saying to itself, "Oh, I am so glad! I am so glad!" End of chapter. Chapter 35 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 35. Bones and Tongues. Bones are strange things. One would suppose that they knew nothing at all about school affairs, but they do. Even Jacob Poot's bones, buried as they were in flesh, were sharp in the matter of study hours. Early on the morning of his return, they ached through and through, giving Jacob a twinge at every stroke of the school bell, as if to say, "Stop that clapper, there's trouble in it." After school, on the contrary, they were quiet and comfortable, in fact, seemed to be taking a nap among their cushions. The other boy's bones behaved in a similar manner, but that is not so remarkable. Being nearer the daylight than Jacob's, they might be expected to be more learned in the ways of the world. Master Ludwig's, especially, were like beauty, only skin deep. They were the most knowing bones you ever heard of. Just put before him ever so quietly a grammar book with a long lesson marked in it, and immediately the sly bone over his eyes would set up such an aching. Request him to go to the garret for your foot stove. Instantly the bones would remind him that he was too tired. Ask him to go to the confectioner's a mile away, and presto, not a bone would remember now that it had ever been used before. Bearing all this in mind, you will not wonder when I tell you that our five boys were among the happiest of the happy throng pouring forth from the schoolhouse that day. Peter was in excellent spirits. He had heard through Hilda of Dame Brinker's laugh and of Hans's joyous words, and he needed no further proof that Ralph Brinker was a cured man. In fact, the news had gone forth in every direction for miles around. Persons who had never before cared for the Brinkers, or even mentioned them, except with a contemptuous sneer or a shrug of pretended pity, now became singularly familiar with every point of their history. There was no end to the number of ridiculous stories that were flying about. Hilda, in the excitement of the moment, had stopped to exchange a word with the doctor's coachman as he stood by the horses, pummeling his chest and clapping his hands. Her kind heart was overflowing. She could not help pausing to tell the cold, tired-looking man that she thought the doctor would be out soon. She even hinted to him that she suspected, only suspected, that a wonderful cure had been performed, an idiot brought to his senses. Nay, she was sure of it, for she had heard his widow laugh. No, not his widow, of course, but his wife, for the man was as much alive as anybody, and, for all she knew, sitting up and talking like a lawyer. All this was very indiscreet. Hilda, in an impenitent sort of way, felt it to be so. But it is always so delightful to impart pleasant or surprising news. She went tripping along by the canal, quite resolved to repeat the sin ad infinitum, and tell nearly every girl and boy in the school. Meantime, Janssen Kolb came skating by. Of course, in 2 seconds he was striking slippery attitudes and shouting saucy things to the coachman, who stared at him in indolent disdain. This to Janssen was equivalent to an invitation to draw nearer. The coachman was now upon his box, gathering up the reins and grumbling at his horses. Janssen accosted him. "I say, what's going on at the idiot's cottage? Is your boss in there?" Coachman nodded mysteriously. "Whew!" whistled Janssen, drawing closer. "Old Brinker dead?" The driver grew big with importance and silent in proportion. "See here, old pincushion, I'd run home yonder and get you a chunk of gingerbread if I thought you could open your mouth." Old pincushion was human. Long hours of waiting had made him ravenously hungry. At Janssen's hint, his countenance showed signs of a collapse. "That's right, old fellow," pursued his tempter. "Hurry up. What news? Old Brinker dead?"
"No, cured. Got his wits," said the coachman, shooting forth his words one at a time like so many bullets. Like bullets, figuratively speaking, they hit Janssen Kolb. He jumped as if he had been shot.
"Gerd Gunst, you don't say so!"
The man pressed his lips together and looked significantly toward Master Kolp's shabby residence. Just then Janzoon saw a group of boys in the distance, hailing them in a rowdy style common to boys of his stamp all over the world, whether in Africa, Japan, Amsterdam, or Paris. He scampered toward them, forgetting coachman, gingerbread, everything but the wonderful news. Therefore, by sundown, it was well known throughout the neighboring country that Dr. Brookman, chancing to stop at the cottage, had given the idiot Brinker a tremendous dose of medicine as brown as gingerbread. It had taken six men to hold him while it was poured down. The idiot had immediately sprung to his feet, in full possession of all his faculties, knocked over the doctor, or thrashed him. There was admitted to be a slight uncertainty as to which of these penalties was inflicted. Then sat down and addressed him for all the world like a lawyer. After that he had turned and spoken beautifully to his wife and children. Dame Brinker had laughed herself into violent hysterics. Hans had said, "Here I am, father, your own dear son," and Gretel had said, "Here I am, father, your own dear Gretel," and the doctor had afterward been seen leaning back in his carriage, looking just as white as a corpse. End of chapter. Chapter 36 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 36. A New Alarm. When Dr. Brookman called the next day at the Brinker cottage, he could not help noticing the cheerful, comfortable aspect of the place. An atmosphere of happiness breathed upon him as he opened the door. Dame Brinker sat complacently knitting beside the bed. Her husband was enjoying a tranquil slumber, and Gretel was noiselessly kneading rye bread on the table in the corner. The doctor did not remain long. He asked a few simple questions, appeared satisfied with the answers, and after feeling his patient's pulse, said, "Ah, very weak yet, Jufvrouw. Very weak indeed. He must have nourishment. You may begin to feed the patient. Ahem. Not too much, but what you do give him, let it be strong and of the best."
"Black bread we have, mynheer, and porridge," replied Dame Brinker cheerily. "They have always agreed with him well."
"Tut, tut," said the doctor, frowning. "Nothing of the kind. He must have the juice of fresh meat, white bread, dried and toasted, good Malaga wine, and, ahem, the man looks cold. Give him more covering, something light and warm. Where is the boy?"
"Hans, mynheer, has gone into Brook to look for work. He will be back soon. Will the meester please be seated?"
Whether the hard-polished stool offered by Dame Brinker did not look particularly tempting, or whether the dame herself frightened him, partly because she was a woman, and partly because an anxious, distressed look had suddenly appeared in her face, I cannot say. Certain it is that our eccentric doctor looked hurriedly about him, muttered something about an extraordinary case, bowed, and disappeared before Dame Brinker had time to say another word. Strange that the visit of their good benefactor should have left a cloud. Yet so it was. Gretel frowned, an anxious, childish frown, and kneaded the bread dough violently without looking up. Dame Brinker hurried to her husband's bedside, leaned over him, and fell into silent but passionate weeping. In a moment Hans entered.
"Why, mother," he whispered in alarm, "what ails thee? Is the father worse?"
She turned her quivering face toward him, making no attempt to conceal her distress.
"Yes, he is starving, perishing. A maester said it."
Hans turned pale.
"What does this mean, mother? We must feed him at once. Here, Gretel, give me the porridge."
"Nay," cried his mother, distractedly, yet without raising her voice, "it may kill him. Our poor fare is too heavy for him. Oh, Hans, he will die. The father will die if we use him this way. He must have meat and sweet wine and a deck bed. Oh, what shall I do? What shall I do? She sobbed, wringing her hands. There is not a stiver in the house.
Gretel pouted. It was the only way she could express sympathy just then. Her tears fell one by one into the dough.
"Did the maester say he must have these things, mother?" asked Hans. "Yes, he did."
"Well, mother, don't cry. He shall have them. I shall bring meat and wine before night. Take the cover from my bed. I can sleep in the straw."
"Yes, Hans, but it is heavy, scant as it is. The maester said he should have something light and warm. He will perish. Our peat is giving out, Hans. The father has wasted it sorely, throwing it on when I was not looking, dear man."
"Never mind, mother," whispered Hans cheerfully. "We can cut down the willow tree and burn it, if need be, but I'll bring home something tonight. There must be work in Amsterdam, though there's none in Brook. Never fear, mother, the worst trouble of all is past. We can brave anything now that the father is himself again."
"Aye," sobbed Dame Brinker, hastily drying her eyes. "That is true indeed."
"Of course it is. Look at him, mother, how softly he sleeps. Do you think God would let him starve, just after giving him back to us? Why, mother, I'm as sure of getting all the father needs as if my pocket were bursting with gold. There now, don't fret."
And hurriedly kissing her, Hans caught up his skates and slipped from the cottage. Poor Hans, disappointed in his morning's errand, half-sickened with this new trouble, he wore a brave look and tried to whistle as he tramped resolutely off with the firm intention of mending matters. Want had never before pressed so sorely upon the Brinker family. Their stock of peat was nearly exhausted, and all the flour in the cottage was in Gretel's dough. They had scarcely cared to eat during the past few days, scarcely realized their condition. Dame Brinker had felt so sure that she and the children could earn money before the worst came that she had given herself up to the joy of her husband's recovery. She had not even told Hans that the few pieces of silver in the old mitten were quite gone. Hans reproached himself now that he had not hailed the doctor when he saw him enter his coach and drive rapidly away in the direction of Amsterdam. Perhaps there is some mistake, he thought. The maester surely would have known that meat and sweet wine were not at our command, and yet the father looks very weak. He certainly does. I must get work. If Mynheer van Holp were back from Rotterdam, I could get plenty to do. But Master Peter told me to let him know if he could do aught to serve us. I shall go to him at once. Oh, if it were but summer! All this time Hans was hastening toward the canal. Soon his skates were on, and he was skimming rapidly toward the residence of Mynheer van Holp.
"The father must have meat and wine at once," he muttered. "But how can I earn the money in time to buy them to-day? There is no other way but to go, as I promised, to Master Peter. What would a gift of meat and wine be to him? When the father is once fed, I can rush down to Amsterdam and earn the morrow's supply."
Then came other thoughts, thoughts that made his heart thump heavily and his cheeks burn with a new shame. It is begging, to say the least. Not one of the Brinkers has ever been a beggar. Shall I be the first? Shall my poor father, just coming back into life, learn that his family has asked for charity? He, always so wise and thrifty? "No," cried Hans aloud, "better a thousand times to part with the watch." "I can at least borrow money on it, in Amsterdam," he thought, turning around. "That will be no disgrace. I can find work at once and get it back again. Nay, perhaps I could even speak to the father about it." This last thought made the lad dance for joy. Why not, indeed, speak to the father? He was a rational being now. He may wake, thought Hans, quite bright and rested, may tell us the watch is of no consequence, to sell it, of course. And Hans almost flew over the ice.
A few moments more and the skates were again swinging from his arm. He was running toward the cottage. His mother met him at the door.
"Oh, Hans!" she cried, her face radiant with joy. "The young lady has been here with her maid. She brought everything, meat, jelly, wine, and bread, a whole basketful. Then the maester sent a man from town with more wine and a fine bed and blankets for the father. Oh, he will get well now. God bless them."
"God bless them," echoed Hans, and for the first time that day his eyes filled with tears. End of chapter.
Chapter 37 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 37, The Father's Return. That evening Ralph Brinker felt so much better that he insisted upon sitting up for a while on the rough, high-backed chair by the fire. For a few moments there was quite a commotion in the little cottage. Hans was all-important on the occasion, for his father was a heavy man and needed something firm to lean upon. The dame, though none of your fragile ladies, was in such a state of alarm and excitement at the bold step they were taking in lifting him without the maester's orders, that she came near pulling her husband over, even while she believed herself to be his main prop and support.
"Steady, Fro, steady," panted Raff. "Have I grown old and feeble, or is it the fever that makes me thus helpless?"
"Hear the man," Dame Brinker laughed, "talking like any other Christian. Why, you're only weak from the fever, Raff. Here's the chair, all fixed snug and warm. Now, sit thee down. Hi, diddy, diddy, there we are."
With these words, Dame Brinker let her half of the burden settle slowly into the chair. Hans prudently did the same. Meanwhile, Gretel flew about generally, bringing every possible thing to her mother to tuck behind the father's back and spread over his knees. Then she twitched the carved bench under his feet, and Hans kicked the fire to make it brighter. The father was sitting up at last. What wonder that he looked about him like one bewildered. Little Hans had just been almost carrying him. The baby was over 4 feet long and was demurely brushing up the hearth with a bundle of will-o'-wisps. Maitje, the vrouw, winsome and fair as ever, had gained at least 50 pounds in what seemed to him a few hours. She also had some new lines in her face that puzzled him. The only familiar things in the room were the pine table that he had made before he was married, the Bible upon the shelf, and the cupboard in the corner. "Ah, Ralph Brinker, it was only natural that your eyes should fill with hot tears even while looking at the joyful faces of your loved ones. 10 years dropped from a man's life are no small loss. 10 years of manhood, of household happiness and care. 10 years of honest labor, of conscious enjoyment of sunshine and outdoor beauty. 10 years of grateful life, one day looking forward to all this, the next waking to find them past and a blank. What wonder the scalding tears dropped one by one upon your cheek?" Tender little Gretel, the prayer of her life was answered through those tears. She loved her father silently at that moment. Hans and his mother glanced silently at each other when they saw her spring toward him and throw her arms about his neck.
"Dear, dear father," she whispered, pressing her cheek close to his, "don't cry. We are all here."
"God bless thee,"
sobbed Ralph, kissing her again and again.
"I had forgotten that."
Soon he looked up again and spoke in a cheerful voice.
"I should know her, Fro," he said, holding the sweet young face between his hands and gazing at it as though he were watching it grow. "I should know her. the same blue eyes and the lips, and, ah me, the little song she could sing almost before she could stand. But that was long ago," he added with a sigh, still looking at her dreamily. "Long ago. It's all gone now."
"Not so, indeed," cried Dame Brinker eagerly. "Do you think I would let her forget it? Gretel, child, sing the old song thou hast known so long."
Ralph Brinker's hand fell wearily, and his eyes closed, but it was something to see the smile playing about his mouth as Gretel's voice floated about him like incense. It was a simple air. She had never known the words. With loving instinct she softened every note, until Ralph almost fancied that his two-year-old baby was once more beside him. As soon as the song was finished, Hans mounted a wooden stool and began to rummage in the cupboard.
"Have a care, Hans," said Dame Brinker, who through all her poverty was ever a tidy housewife. "Have a care. The wine is there at your right, and the white bread beyond it."
"Never fear, mother," answered Hans, reaching far back on an upper shelf. "I shall do no mischief." Jumping down, he walked toward his father and placed an oblong block of pine wood in his hands. One of its ends was rounded off, and some deep cuts had been made on the top.
"Do you know what that is, father?" asked Hans.
Ralph Brinker's face brightened. "Indeed I do, boy. It is the boat I was making you alack, not yesterday, but years ago."
"I have kept it ever since, father. It can be finished when your hand grows strong again."
"Yes, but not for you, my lad. I must wait for the grandchildren. Why, you are nearly a man. Have you helped your mother through all these years?"
"Aye, and bravely," put in Dame Brinker.
"Let me see," muttered the father, looking in a puzzled way at them all. "How long is it since the night when the waters were coming in? 'Tis the last I remember."
"We have told thee true, Ralph. It was 10 years last Pinkster week."
10 years. And I fell then, you say. Has the fever been on me ever since?"
Dame Brinker scarcely knew how to reply. Should she tell him all? Tell him that he had been an idiot, almost a lunatic? The doctor had charged her on no account to worry or excite his patient. Hans and Gretel looked astonished.
"Like enough, Ralph," she said, nodding her head and raising her eyebrows. "When a heavy man like thee falls on his head, it's hard to say what will come. But thou art well now, Ralph, thank the good Lord."
The newly awakened man bowed his head.
"Aye, well enough, mine Frau," he said after a moment's silence. "But my brain turns somehow like a spinning wheel. It will not be right till I get on the dikes again. When shall I be at work, think you?"
"Hear the man!" cried Dame Brinker, delighted, yet frightened too, for that matter. "We must get him on the bed, Hans. Work indeed!"
They tried to raise him from the chair, but he was not ready yet. "Be off with ye," he said with something like his old smile. Gretel had never seen it before. "Does a man want to be lifted about like a log? I tell you, before three suns I shall be on the dikes again. Ah, there'll be some stout fellows to greet me. Jan Kampfhulsen and young Hugsfleet, they have been good friends to thee, Hans, I'll warrant."
Hans looked at his mother. Young Hugsfleet had been dead 5 years. Jan Kampfhulsen was in the jail at Amsterdam.
"Aye, they'd have done their share, no doubt," said Dame Brinker, parrying the inquiry, "had we asked them. But what with working and studying, Hans has been busy enough without seeking comrades." "Working and studying," echoed Ralph in a musing tone. "Can the youngsters read and cipher, Maitje?"
"You should hear them," she answered proudly. "They can run through a book while I mop the floor. Hans there is as happy over a page of big words as a rabbit in a cabbage patch. As for ciphering—"
"Here, lad, help a bit," interrupted Ralph Brinker. "I must get me on the bed again."
End of chapter.
Chapter 38 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or the Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 38. The Thousand Guilders. None seeing the humble supper eaten in the Brinker cottage that night would have dreamed of the dainty repast hidden away nearby. Hans and Gretel looked rather wistfully toward the cupboard as they drank their cupful of water and ate their scanty share of black bread, but even in thought they did not rob their father. "He relished his supper well," said Dame Brinker, nodding sidewise toward the bed, "and fell asleep the next moment. Ah, the dear man will be feeble for many a day. He wanted sore to sit up again, but while I made show of humoring him and getting ready, he dropped off. Remember that, my girl, when you have a man of your own, and many a day may it be before that comes to pass. Remember that you can never rule by differing. Humble wife is husband's boss. Tut, tut, never swallow such a mouthful as that again, child. Why, I could make a meal off two such pieces. What's in thee, Hans? One would think there were cobwebs on the walls." "Oh, no, mother, I was only thinking." "Thinking about what? Ah, no use asking," she added in a changed tone. "I was thinking of the same a while ago. Well, it's no blame if we did look to hear something by this time about the Thousand Guilders. But not a word, no. It's plain enough he knows naught about them." Hans looked up anxiously, dreading lest his mother should grow agitated, as usual, when speaking of the lost money. But she was silently nibbling her bread and looking with a doleful stare toward the window. "Thousand guilders," echoed a faint voice from the bed. "Ah, I am sure they have been of good use to you, Vrouw, through the long years when your man was idle." The poor woman started up. These words quite destroyed the hope that of late had been glowing within her. "Are you awake, Raff?" she faltered. "Yes, Maitje, and I feel much better. Our money was well saved, Vrouw, I was saying. Did it last through all those 10 years? I have not got it, Raff. She was going to tell him the whole truth when Hans lifted his finger warningly and whispered, "Remember what the Maester told us. The father must not be worried." "Speak to him, child," she answered, trembling. Hans hurried to the bedside. "I am glad you are feeling better," he said, leaning over his father. "Another day will see you quite strong again." "Aye, like enough. How long did the money last, Hans? I could not hear your mother. What did she say?"
I said, Raff," stammered Dame Brinker in great distress, "that it was all gone."
"Well, wife, do not fret at that. 1,000 guilders is not so very much for 10 years, and with children to bring up. But it has helped to make you all comfortable. Have you had much sickness to bear?"
"No, no,"
sobbed Dame Brinker, lifting her apron to her eyes. "Tut, tut, woman, why do you cry?" said Raff kindly. "We will soon fill another pouch when I am on my feet again. Lucky I told you all about it before I fell."
"Told me what, man?"
"Why, that I buried the money. In my dream just now it seemed that I had never said aught about it." Dame Brinker started forward. Hans caught her arm.
"Hist, mother," he whispered, hastily leading her away. "We must be very careful."
Then, while she stood with clasped hands, waiting in breathless anxiety, he once more approached the cot. Trembling with eagerness, he said,
"That was a troublesome dream. Do you remember when you buried the money, father?"
"Yes, my boy. It was just before daylight, on the same day I was hurt."
Jan Kamhusen said something, the sundown before, that made me distrust his honesty. He was the only one living besides mother who knew that we had saved 1,000 guilders. So I rose up that night and buried the money, blockhead that I was ever to suspect an old friend.
"I'll be bound, father," pursued Hans in a laughing voice, motioning to his mother and Gretel to remain quiet, "that you've forgotten where you buried it."
"Ha, ha, ha! Not I, indeed. But good night, my son, I can sleep again."
Hans would have walked away, but his mother's gestures were not to be disobeyed, so he said gently, "Good night, father. Where did you say you buried the money? I was only a little one then."
"Close by the willow sapling, behind the cottage," said Ralph Brinker drowsily.
"Ah, yes, north side of the tree, wasn't it, father?"
"No, the south side. Ah, you know the spot well enough, you rogue. Like enough you were there when your mother lifted it. Now, son, easy. Shift this pillow so. Good night."
"Good night, father," said Hans, ready to dance for joy. The moon rose very late that night, shining in full and clear at the little window, but its beams did not disturb Ralph Brinker. He slept soundly. So did Gretel. As for Hans and his mother, they had something else to do. After making a few hurried preparations, they stole forth with bright, expectant faces, bearing a broken spade and a rusty implement that had done many a day's service when Ralph was a hale worker on the dikes. It was so light out of doors that they could see the willow tree distinctly. The frozen ground was hard as stone, but Hans and his mother were resolute. Their only dread was that they might disturb the sleepers in the cottage.
"This icebreaker is just the thing, mother," said Hans, striking many a vigorous blow. "But the ground has set so firm it'll be a fair match for it."
"Never fear, Hans," she answered, watching him eagerly. "Here, let me try a while." They soon succeeded in making an impression. One opening, and the rest was not so difficult. Still they worked on, taking turns and whispering cheerily to one another. Now and then Dame Brinker stepped noiselessly over the threshold and listened, to be certain that her husband slept. "What grand news it will be for him!" she said, laughing. "But he is strong enough to bear it. How I should like to put the pouch and the stocking, just as we find them, all full of money, near him this blessed night, for the dear man to see when he wakens."
"We must get them first, mother," panted Hans, still tugging away at his work.
"There's no doubt of that. They can't slip away from us now," she answered, shivering with cold and excitement as she crouched beside the opening. "Like enough we'll find them stowed in the old earthen pot I lost long ago." By this time Hans, too, began to tremble, but not with cold. He had penetrated a foot deep for quite a space on the south side of the tree. At any moment they might come upon the treasure. Meantime the stars winked and blinked at each other as if to say, "Queer country, this Holland. How much we do see, to be sure."
"Strange that the dear father should have put it down so woeful deep," said Dame Brinker in rather a provoked tone. "Ah, the ground was soft enough then, I warrant. How wise of him to mistrust Jan Kamphulsen, and Jan in full credit at the time. Little I thought that handsome fellow with his gay ways would ever go to jail. Now, Hans, let me take a turn. It's lighter work, d'ye see, the deeper we go. I'd be loath to kill the tree, Hans. Will we harm it, do you think?"
"I cannot say," he answered gravely. Hour after hour, mother and son worked on. The hole grew larger and deeper. Clouds began to gather in the sky, throwing elfish shadows as they passed. Not until moon and stars faded away and streaks of daylight began to appear did Mateship Brinker and Hans look hopelessly into each other's faces. They had searched the ground thoroughly, desperately, all round the tree, south, north, east, west, The hidden money was not there.
End of chapter.
Chapter 39 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 39. Glimpses. Annie Bowman had a healthy distaste for Janson Kolp. Janson Kolp, in his own rough way, adored Annie. Annie declared that she could not, to save her life, say one civil word to that odious boy. Janson believed her to be the sweetest, sauciest creature in the world. Annie laughed among her playmates at the comical flapping of Janson's tattered and dingy jacket. He sighed in solitude over the floating grace of her jaunty blue petticoat. She thanked her stars that her brothers were not like the Culps, and he growled at his sister because she was not like the Bowmans. His presence made her harsh and unfeeling, and the very sight of her made him gentle as a lamb. Of course they were thrown together very often. It is thus that in some mysterious way we are convinced of error and cured of prejudice. In this case, however, the scheme failed. Annie detested Janson more and more at each encounter, and Janson liked her better and better every day. "He killed a stork, the wicked old wretch," she would say to herself. "She knows I am strong and fearless," thought Janson. "How red and freckled and ugly he is," was Annie's secret comment when she looked at him. "How she stares and stares," thought Janson. "Well, I am a fine, weather-beaten fellow, anyway." "Janson Kolp, you impudent boy, go right away from me," Annie often said. "I don't want any of your company." "Ha, ha," laughed Janson to himself. "Girls never say what they mean. I'll skate with her every chance I can get." And so it came to pass that the pretty maid would not look up that morning when, skating homeward from Amsterdam, she became convinced that a great burly boy was coming down the canal toward her. "Huh! If I look at him," thought Annie, "I'll—" "Good morrow, Annie Bowman," said a pleasant voice. How a smile brightens a girl's face! "Good morrow, Master Hans. I am right glad to meet you." How a smile brightens a boy's face! "Good morrow again, Annie. There has been a great change at our house since you left." "How so?" she exclaimed, opening her eyes very wide. Hans, who had been in a great hurry and rather moody, grew talkative and quite at leisure in Annie's sunshine. Turning about and skating slowly with her toward Brook, he told the good news of his father. Annie was so true a friend that he told her even of their present distress, of how money was needed, and how everything depended upon his obtaining work, and he could find nothing to do in the neighborhood. All this was not said as a complaint, but just because she was looking at him and really wished to know. He could not speak of last night's bitter disappointment, for that secret was not wholly his own. "Good-bye, Annie," he said at last. "The morning is going fast, and I must haste to Amsterdam and sell these skates. Mother must have money at once. Before nightfall I shall certainly find a job somewhere."
"Sell your new skates, Hans?" cried Annie. "You, the best skater around Brook? Why, the race is coming off in 5 days."
"I know it," he answered resolutely. "Good-bye. I shall skate home again on the old wooden ones." Such a bright glance, so different from Janson's ugly grin, and Hans was off like an arrow.
"Hans, come back," she called.
Her voice changed the arrow into a top. Spinning around, he darted in one long leaning sweep toward her.
"Then you really are going to sell your new skates, if you can find a customer?" "Well, Hans, if you are going to sell your skates," said Annie, quite confused, "I mean if you, well, I know somebody who would like to buy them, that's all."
"Not Janssen Kolp?" asked Hans, flushing.
"Oh, no," she said, pouting. "He is not one of my friends."
"But you know him," persisted Hans.
Annie laughed. "Yes, I know him, and it's all the worse for him that I do. Now, please, Hans, don't ever talk any more to me about Janssen. I hate him."
"Hate him? You hate anybody, Annie?"
She shook her head saucily.
"Yes, and I'll hate you, too, if you persist in calling him one of my friends. You boys may like him because he caught the greased goose at the Kermes last summer and climbed the pole with his great ugly body tied up in a sack, but I don't care for such things. I've disliked him ever since I saw him try to push his little sister out of the merry-go-round at Amsterdam, and it's no secret up our way who killed the stork on your mother's roof. But we mustn't talk about such a bad, wicked fellow. Really, Hans, I know somebody who would be glad to buy your skates. You won't get half a price for them in Amsterdam. Please give them to me. I'll take you the money this very afternoon."
If Annie was charming when she said hate, there was no withstanding her when she said please. At least Hans found it to be so. "Annie," he said, taking off the skates and rubbing them carefully with a snarl of twine before handing them to her, "I am sorry to be so particular, but if your friend should not want them, would you bring them back to me today? I must buy Pete a meal for the mother early tomorrow morning."
"My friend will want them,"
Annie laughed, nodding gaily, and skated off at the top of her speed. As Hans drew forth the wooden runners from his capacious pockets and fastened them on as best he could, he did not hear Annie murmur,
"I wish I had not been so rude. Poor, brave Hans, what a noble boy he is."
And as Annie skated homeward, filled with pleasant thoughts, she did not hear Hans say,
"I grumbled like a bear, but bless her, some girls are like angels."
Perhaps it was all for the best. One cannot be expected to know everything that is going on around the world. End of chapter.
Chapter 40 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 40. Looking for Work. Luxuries unfit us for returning to hardships easily endured before. The wooden runners squeaked more than ever. It was as much as Hans could do to get on with the clumsy old things. Still, he did not regret that he had parted with his beautiful skates, but resolutely pushed back the boyish trouble that he had not been able to keep them just a little longer, at least until after the race. "Mother surely will not be angry with me," he thought, "for selling them without her leave. She has had care enough already. It will be full time to speak of it when I take home the money." Hans went up and down the streets of Amsterdam that day, looking for work. He succeeded in earning a few stivers by assisting a man who was driving a train of loaded mules into the city, but he could not secure steady employment anywhere. He would have been glad to obtain a situation as porter or errand boy, but though he passed on his way many a loitering, shuffling urchin laden with bundles, there was no place for him. Some shopkeepers had just supplied themselves, others needed a trimmer, more lightly built fellow. They meant better dressed, but did not choose to say so. Others told him to call again in a month or two, when the canals would probably be broken up, and many shook their heads at him without saying a word. At the factories he met with no better luck.
It seemed to him that in those great buildings, turning out respectively such tremendous quantities of woolen, cotton, and linen stuffs, such world-renowned dyes and paints, such precious diamonds cut from the rough, such supplies of meal, of bricks, of glass and china, that in at least one of these, a strong-armed boy, able and eager to work, could find something to do. But no, nearly the same answer met him everywhere. No need of more hands just now. If he had called before St. Nicholas's day, they might have given him a job, as they were hurried then, but at present they had more boys than they needed. Hans wished they could see, just for a moment, his mother and Gretel. He did not know how the anxiety of both looked out from his eyes, and how, more than once, the gruffest denials were uttered with an uncomfortable consciousness that the lad ought not to be turned away. Certain fathers, when they went home that night, spoke more kindly than usual to their youngsters. From memory of a frank young face saddened at their words, and before morning one man actually resolved that he would instruct his head man, Blankert, to set the boy from Brook at something if he should come in again. But Hans knew nothing of all this. Toward sundown he started on his return to Brook, uncertain whether the strange, choking sensation in his throat arose from discouragement or resolution. There was certainly one more chance. Mynheer van Hoop might have returned by this time. Master Peter, it was reported, had gone to Haarlem the night before to attend to something connected with the great skating race. Still, Hans would go and try. Fortunately, Peter had returned early that morning. He was at home when Hans reached there, and was just about starting for the Brinker cottage. "Ah, Hans!" he cried, as the weary boy approached the door. "You are the very one I wish to see. Come in and warm yourself." After tugging at his well-worn hat, which always would stick to his head when he was embarrassed, Hans knelt down, not by way of making a new style of Oriental salute, nor to worship the goddess of cleanliness who presided there, but because his heavy shoes would have filled the soul of a Brook housewife with horror. When their owner stepped softly into the house, they were left outside to act as sentinels until his return. Hans left the Van Hoop mansion with a lightened heart. Peter had brought word from Haarlem that young Brinker was to commence working upon the summer-house doors immediately. There was a comfortable workshop on the place, and it was to be at his service until the carving was done. Peter did not tell him that he had skated all the way to Haarlem for the purpose of arranging this plan with Mynheer van Hoop. It was enough for him to see the glad, eager look rise on young Brinker's face. "I think I can do it," said Hans, "although I have never learned the trade." "I'm sure you can," responded Peter heartily. "You will find every tool you require in the workshop. It is nearly hidden yonder by that wall of twigs. In summer, when the hedge is green, one cannot see the shop from here at all. How is your father today?" "Better, mynheer. He improves every hour." "It is the most astonishing thing I ever heard of. That gruff old doctor is a great fellow after all." "Ah, mynheer," said Hans warmly, "he is more than great. He is good. But for the maester's kind heart and great skill, my poor father would yet be in the dark. I think, mynheer," he added with kindling eyes, "surgery is the very noblest science in the world." Peter shrugged his shoulders. "Very noble it may be, but not quite to my taste. This Dr. Buchmann certainly has skill. As for his heart, defend me from such hearts as his." "Why do you say so, mynheer?" asked Hans. Just then a lady slowly entered from an adjoining apartment. It was Mevrouw van Hoop, arrayed in the grandest of caps and the longest of satin aprons, ruffled with lace. She nodded placidly as Hans stepped back from the fire, bowing as well as he knew how. Peter at once drew a high-backed oaken chair toward the fire, and the lady seated herself. There was a block of cork on each side of the chimney-place. One of these he placed under his mother's feet. Hans turned to go.
"Wait a moment, if you please, young man," said the lady. "I accidentally overheard you and my son speaking, I think, of my friend Dr. Bookman."
"You are right, young man. Dr. Bookman has a very kind heart. You perceive, Peter, that we may be quite mistaken in judging a person solely by his manners, though a courteous deportment is by no means to be despised."
"I intended no disrespect, mother," said Peter, "but surely one has no right to go growling and snarling through the world as they say he does."
"They say? Ah, Peter, they means everybody or nobody. Surgeon Bookman has a great sorrow. Many years ago he lost his only child under very painful circumstances. A fine lad, except that he was a thought too hasty and high-spirited. Before them, Gerard Bookman was one of the most agreeable gentlemen I ever knew."
So saying, Mevrouw van Hoop, looking kindly upon the two boys, rose and left the room with the same dignity with which she had entered. Peter, only half convinced, muttered something about the sin of allowing sorrow to turn all one's honey into gall, as he conducted his visitor to the narrow side door. Before they parted, he advised Hans to keep himself in good skating order, "for," he added, "now that your father is all right, you will be in fine spirits for the race. That will be the prettiest skating show ever seen in this part of the world. Everybody is talking of it. You are to try for the prize, remember."
"I shall not be in the race, mynheer," said Hans, looking down.
"Not in the race? Why not, indeed?"
And immediately Peter's thought swept on a full tide of suspicion toward Carl Schummel.
"Because I cannot, mynheer," answered Hans as he bent to slip his feet into his big shoes. Something in the boy's manner warned Peter that it would be no kindness to press the matter further. He bade Hans good-bye and stood thoughtfully watching him as he walked away. In a minute Peter called out, "Hans Brinker!"
"Yes, mynheer."
"I'll take back all I said about Dr. Bookman."
"Yes, mynheer."
Both were laughing, but Peter's smile changed to a look of puzzled surprise when he saw Hans kneel down by the canal and put on the wooden skates.
"Very queer," muttered Peter, shaking his head as he turned to go into the house. "Why in the world doesn't the boy wear his new ones?" End of chapter.
Chapter 41 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or the Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 41, The Fairy Godmother. The sun had gone down quite out of sight when our hero, with a happy heart but with something like a sneer on his countenance as he jerked off the wooden runners, trudged hopefully toward the tiny hut-like building known of old as the Idiot's Cottage. Duller eyes than his would have discerned two slight figures moving near the doorway. That gray, well-patched jacket and the dull blue skirt covered with an apron of still duller blue, that faded close-fitting cap, and those quick little feet in their great boat-like shoes, they were Gretel's, of course. He would have known them anywhere. That bright, coquettish red jacket, with its pretty skirt bordered with black, that graceful cap bobbing over the gold earrings, that dainty apron, and those snug leather shoes that seemed to have grown with the feet, why, if the Pope of Rome had sent them to him by express, Hans could have sworn they were Annie's. The two girls were slowly pacing up and down in front of the cottage. Their arms were entwined, of course, and their heads were nodding and shaking as emphatically as if all the affairs of the kingdom were under discussion.
With a joyous shout, Hans hastened toward them. "Huzzah, girls! I have found work!" That brought his mother to the cottage door. She, too, had pleasant tidings. The father was still improving. He had been sitting up nearly all day and was now sleeping, as Dame Brinker declared, just as quiet as a lamb. "It is my turn now, Hans," said Annie, drawing him aside after he had told his mother the good word from Mynheer van Hoop. "Your skates are sold, and here's the money."
7 guilders!" cried Hans, counting the pieces in astonishment. "Why, that is 3 times as much as I paid for them."
"I cannot help that," said Annie. "If the buyer knew no better, that is not our fault." Hans looked up quickly. "Oh, Annie!"
"Oh, Hans!" she mimicked, pursing her lips and trying to look desperately wicked and unprincipled. "Now, Annie, I know you would never mean that. You must return some of this money." "But I'll not do any such thing," insisted Annie. "They're sold, and that's an end of it."
Then, seeing that he looked really pained, she added in a lower tone, "Will you believe me, Hans, when I say that there has been no mistake, that the person who bought your skates insisted upon paying 7 guilders for them?"
"I will," he answered, and the light from his clear blue eyes seemed to settle and sparkle under Annie's lashes. Dame Brinker was delighted at the sight of so much silver, but when she learned that Hans had parted with his treasures to obtain it, she sighed and then exclaimed,
"Bless thee, child, that will be a sore loss for thee."
"Here, mother," said the boy, plunging his hands far into his pocket, "here is more. We shall be rich if we keep on."
"Aye, indeed," she answered, eagerly reaching forth her hand.
Then, lowering her voice, added, "We should be rich but for that Jan Kampulsen. He was at the willow tree years ago, Hans, depend upon it."
"Indeed, it seems likely," sighed Hans.
"Well, mother, we must give up the money bravely. It is certainly gone. The father has told us all he knows. Let us think no more about it."
"That's easy saying, Hans. I shall try, but it's hard, and my poor man wanting so many comforts. Bless me, how girls fly about! They were here but this instant. Where did they run to?"
"They slipped behind the cottage," said Hans, "like enough to hide from us.
Hist! I'll catch them for you.
They both can move quicker and softer than yonder rabbit, but I'll give them a good start first."
"Why, there is a rabbit, sure enough. Hold, Hans, the poor thing must have been in sore need to venture from its burrow in this bitter weather. I'll get a few crumbs for it within."
So saying, the good woman bustled into the cottage. She soon came out again, but Hans had forgotten to wait, and the rabbit, after taking a cool survey of the premises, had scampered off to unknown quarters. Turning the corner of the cottage, Dame Brinker came upon the children. Hans and Gretel were standing before Annie, who was seated carelessly upon a stump.
"That is as good as a picture," cried Dame Brinker, halting in admiration of the group. "Many a painting have I seen at the grand house at Heidelberg, not a whit prettier. My 2 are rough chubs, Annie, but you look like a fairy."
"Do I?" laughed Annie, sparkling with animation. "Well, then, Gretel and Hans, imagine I'm your godmother just paying you a visit. Now I'll grant you each a wish. What will you have, Master Hans?" A shade of earnestness passed over Annie's face as she looked up at him. Perhaps it was because she wished from the depths of her heart that for once she could have a fairy's power. Something whispered to Hans that, for a moment, she was more than mortal.
"I wish," said he solemnly, "that I could find something I was searching for last night."
Gretel laughed merrily. Dame Brinker moaned,
"Shame on you, Hans!"
and she went wearily into the cottage. The fairy godmother sprang up and stamped her foot 3 times.
"Thou shalt have thy wish," said she. "Let them say what they will."
Then, with playful solemnity, she put her hand in her apron pocket and drew forth a large glass bead. "Bury this," said she, giving it to Hans, "where I have stamped, and ere moonrise, thy wish shall be granted." Gretel laughed more merrily than ever. The godmother pretended great displeasure. "Naughty child," said she, scowling terribly, "in punishment for laughing at a fairy, thy wish shall not be granted." "Ha ha ha ha!" cried Gretel in high glee. "Better wait till you're asked, godmother. I haven't made any wish." Annie acted her part well. Never smiling, through all their merry laughter, she stalked away, the embodiment of offended dignity. "Good night, fairy," they cried again and again. "Good night, mortals," she called out at last as she sprang over a frozen ditch and ran quickly homeward. "Oh, isn't she just like flowers, so sweet and lovely," cried Gretel, looking after her in great admiration. "And to think how many days she stays in that dark room with her grandmother. Why, brother Hans, what is the matter? What are you going to do?"
"Wait and see," answered Hans as he plunged into the cottage and came out again, all in an instant, bearing the spade and ace-breaker in his hands. "I'm going to bury my magic bead." Ralph Brinker still slept soundly. His wife took a small block of peat from her nearly exhausted store and put it upon the embers. Then, opening the door, she called gently, "Come in, children."
"Mother, mother, see here!" shouted Hans.
"Holy Saint Bavon!" exclaimed the dame, springing over the doorstep. "What ails the boy?"
"Come quick, mother!" he cried in great excitement, working with all his might and driving in the ace-breaker at each word.
"Don't you see? This is the spot, right here on the south side of the stump. Why didn't we think of it last night? The stump is the old willow tree, the one you cut down last spring because it shaded the potatoes. That little tree wasn't here when father... Huzzah!"
Dame Brinker could not speak. She dropped on her knees beside Hans just in time to see him drag forth the old stone pot. He thrust in his hand and took out a piece of brick, then another, then the stocking and the pouch, black and moldy, but filled with the long-lost treasure. Such a time! Such laughing! Such crying! Such counting after they went into the cottage! It was a wonder that Ralph did not waken. His dreams were pleasant, however, for he smiled in his sleep. Dame Brinker and her children had a fine supper, I can assure you. No need of saving the delicacies now. "We'll get father some nice fresh things tomorrow," Dame Brinker said as she brought forth cold meat, wine, bread, and jelly, and placed them on the clean pine table. "Sit by, children, sit by." That night Annie fell asleep wondering whether it was a knife Hans had lost, and thinking how funny it would be if he should find it after all. Hans had scarcely closed his eyes before he found himself trudging along a thicket. Pots of gold were lying all around, and watches, and skates, and glittering beads were swinging from every branch. Strange to say, each tree, as he approached it, changed into a stump, and on the stump sat the prettiest fairy imaginable, clad in a scarlet jacket and a blue petticoat. End of chapter. Chapter 42 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 42, The Mysterious Watch. Something else than the missing guilders was brought to light on the day of the fairy godmother's visit. This was the story of the watch that for 10 long years had been so jealously guarded by Raff's faithful Fro. Through many an hour of sore temptation she had dreaded almost to look upon it, lest she might be tempted to disobey her husband's request. It had been hard to see her children hungry, and to know that the watch, if sold, would enable the roses to bloom in their cheeks again. "But nay," she would exclaim, "Maidship Brinker is not one to forget her man's last bidding, come what may." "Take good care of this, mine Frau," he had said as he handed it to her. That was all. No explanation followed, for the words were scarcely spoken when one of his fellow workmen rushed into the cottage, crying, "Come, man, the waters are rising. You're wanted on the dikes." Raff had started at once, and that was the last Dame Brinker saw of him in his right mind. On the day when Hans was in Amsterdam looking for work, and Gretel, after performing her household labors, was wandering in search of chips, twigs, anything that could be burned, Dame Brinker, with suppressed excitement, had laid the watch in her husband's hand. "It wasn't in reason," as she afterwards said to Hans, "to wait any longer, when a word from the father would settle all. No woman living but would want to know how he came by that watch." Raff Brinker turned the bright polished thing over and over in his hand. Then he examined the bit of smoothly ironed black ribbon fastened to it. He seemed hardly to recognize it. At last he said, "Ah, I remember this. Why, you've been rubbing it, Fro, till it shines like a new guilder." "Aye," said Dame Brinker, nodding her head complacently. Raff looked at it again. "Poor boy," he murmured, then fell into a brown study. This was too much for the dame. "Poor boy," she echoed somewhat tartly. "What do you think I'm standing here for, Raff Brinker, and my spinning awaiting, if not to hear more than that?" "I told ye all long since," said Raff positively, as he looked up in surprise. "Indeed, and you never did," retorted the Fro. "Well, if not, since it's no affair of ours, we'll say no more about it," said Raff, shaking his head sadly. "Like enough, while I've been dead on the earth all this time, the poor boy's died and been in heaven. He looked near enough to it, poor lad."
"Raff Brinker, if you're going to treat me this way, and I nursing you and bearing with you since I was 22 years old, it's a shame, I and a disgrace," cried the Fro, growing quite red and scant of breath. Raff's voice was feeble yet.
"Treat you what way, mate you?"
"What way?" said Dame Brinker, mimicking his voice and manner. "What way? Why, just as every woman in the world is treated after she stood by a man through the worst, like a—"
"Mate you?" Raff was leaning forward with outstretched arms. His eyes were full of tears. In an instant Dame Brinker was at his feet, clasping his hands in hers.
"Oh, what have I done? Made my good man cry, and he not back with me 4 days. Look up, Raff." "Nay, Raff, my own boy, I'm sorry I hurt thee. It's hard not to be told about the watch after waiting 10 years to know, but I'll ask thee no more, Raff. Here, we'll put the thing away that's made the first trouble between us, after God just gave thee back to me."
"I was a fool to cry, mate you," he said, kissing her, "and it's no more than right that ye should know the truth. But it seemed as if it might be telling the secrets of the dead to talk about the matter."
"Is the man, the lad, thou wert talking of dead, think thee?" asked the Fro, hiding the watch in her hand, but seating herself expectantly on the end of his long footbench.
"It's hard telling," he answered.
"Was he so sick, Raff?"
"No, not sick, I may say. But troubled, Fro, very troubled."
"Had he done wrong, think ye?" she asked, lowering her voice.
Raff nodded.
"Murder?" whispered the wife, not daring to look up.
He said it was like to that, indeed.
Oh, Raff, you frighten me. Tell me more. You speak so strange, and you tremble. I must know all.
If I tremble, mein Frau, it must be from the fever. There is no guilt on my soul, thank God.
Take a sip of this wine, Raff. There, now you are better. It was like to a crime, you were saying.
I made you, like to murder. That he told me himself. But I'll never believe it. A likely lad, fresh and honest-looking as our own youngster, but with something not so bold and straight about him.
I know, said the dame gently, fearing to interrupt the story.
He came upon me quite suddenly, continued Raff. I had never seen his face before, the palest, frightenedest face that ever was. He caught me by the arm. You look like an honest man, says he.
Aye, he was right in that, interrupted the dame emphatically.
Raff looked somewhat bewildered. Where was I, mein Frau?
The lad took hold of your arm, Raff, she said, gazing at him anxiously.
Aye, so. The words come awkward to me, and everything is like a dream, you see.
Stud, what wonder, poor man! She sighed, stroking his hand. If he had not had enough for a dozen, the wit would never have come to ye again. Well, the lad caught me by the arm and said ye looked honest. Well, he might. What then? Was it noontime?
Nay, before daylight, long before early chimes.
It was the same day you were hurt, said the dame. I know it seemed that you went to your work in the middle of the night. You left off where he caught your arm, Raff.
Yes, resumed her husband, and I can see his face this minute, so white and wild-looking. Take me down this river away, says he. I was working then, you remember, far down on the line across from Amsterdam. I told him I was no boatman. It's an affair of life and death, says he. Take me on a few miles. Yonder skiff is not locked, but it may be a poor man's boat, and I'd be loath to rob him. The words might differ some, Fro, for it's all like a dream. Well, I took him down. It might be 6 or 8 miles, and then he said he could run the rest of the way on shore. I was in haste to get the boat back. Before he jumped out, he says, sobbing like, I can trust you. I've done a thing. God knows I never intended it, but the man is dead. I must fly from Holland.
What was it? Did he say, Raff? Had he been shooting at a comrade, as they do down at the university at Göttingen?
I can't recall that. Mayhap he told me, but it's all like a dream. I said it wasn't for me, a good Hollander, to cheat the laws of my country by helping him off that way. But he kept saying, God knows I am innocent. And he looked at me in the starlight as fair now and clear-eyed as our little Hans might, and I just pulled away faster.
It must have been Jan Kampulsen's boat, remarked Dame Brinker dryly. None other would have left his oars out that careless.
Aye, it was Jan's boat, sure enough. The man will be coming in to see me Sunday, likely, if he's heard, and young Husvliet, too. Where was I?
Where were you? Why, not very far, forsooth. The lad hadn't yet given ye the watch. Alack, I misgive whether he came by it honestly.
Why, Fro, exclaimed Raff Brinker in an injured tone, he was dressed soft and fine as the prince himself. The watch was his own, clear enough.
How came he to give it up? Asked the dame, looking uneasily at the fire, for it needed another block of peat.
I told ye just now, he answered with a puzzled air.
Tell me again, said Dame Brinker, wisely warding off another digression.
Well, just before jumping from the boat, he says, handing me the watch, "I'm flying from my country as I never thought I could. I'll trust you because you look honest. Will you take this to my father? Not today, but in a week, and tell him his unhappy boy sent it, and tell him if ever the time comes that he wants me to come back to him, I'll brave everything and come. Tell him to send a letter to there, the rest is all gone from me. I can't remember where the letter was to go. Poor lad, poor lad," resumed Raff, sorrowfully, taking the watch from his fro's lap as he spoke. "And it's never been sent to his father to this day."
"I'll take it, Raff, never fear. The moment Gretel gets back, she will be in soon. What was the father's name, did you say? Where were you to find him?"
"Alack," answered Raff, speaking very slowly, "it's all slipped me. I can see the lad's face and his great eyes just as plain, and I remember his opening the watch and snatching something from it and kissing it, but no more. All the rest whirls past me. There's a sound like rushing water comes over me when I try to think."
"Aye, that's plain to see, Raff, but I've had the same feeling after a fever. You're tired now. I must get ye straight on the bed again. Where is the child, I wonder?"
Dame Brinker opened the door and called, "Gretel! Gretel!" "Stand aside, Fro," said Raff feebly, as he leaned forward and endeavored to look out upon the bare landscape. "I've half a mind to stand beyond the door just once."
"Nay, nay," she laughed. "I'll tell the maester how ye tease and fidget and bother to be let out in the air, and if he says it, I'll bundle ye warm tomorrow and give ye a turn on your feet. But I'm freezing you with this door open. I declare if there isn't Gretel with her apron full, skating on the canal like wild. Why, man," she continued, almost in a scream as she slammed the door, "thou art walking to the bed without my touching thee. Thou'lt fall."
The dame's "thee" proved her mingled fear and delight even more than the rush which she made toward her husband. Soon he was comfortably settled under the new cover, declaring, as his fro tucked him in snug and warm, that it was the last daylight that should see him abed.
I can hope it myself," laughed Dame Brinker, "now you have been frisking about at that rate."
As Raff closed his eyes, the dame hastened to revive her fire, or rather to dull it, for Dutch Pete is like a Dutchman, slow to kindle, but very good at a blaze once started. Then, putting her neglected spinning-wheel away, she drew forth her knitting from some invisible pocket and seated herself by the bedside.
"If you could remember the man's name, Raff," she began cautiously, "I might take the watch to him while you're sleeping. Gretel can't but be in soon."
Raff tried to think, but in vain.
"Could it be Boomphoffen?" suggested the dame. "I've heard how they've had two sons turn out bad, Gerard and Lambert."
"It might be," said Raff. "Look if there's letters on the watch. That'll guide us some."
"Bless thee, man," cried the happy dame, eagerly lifting the watch. "Why, thou'rt sharper than ever. Sure enough, here's letters, L.J.B. That's Lambert Boomphoffen, you may depend. What the J is for, I can't say, but they used to be grand kind of people, high-feathered as fancy fowl, just the kind to give their children all double names, which isn't scripture, anyway."
"I don't know about that, Fro. Seems to me there's long mixed names in the Holy Book, hard enough to make out. But you've got the right guess at a jump. It was your way always," said Raff, closing his eyes. "Take the watch to Boompkinks and try." "Aye, take it there."
"Take it there, man?"
Why, the whole brood of them's been gone to America these 4 years. But go to sleep, Raff. You look pale and out of strength. It'll all come to you. What's best to do in the morning? So, Mistress Gretel, here you are at last.
Before Raff awoke that evening, the fairy godmother, as we know, had been in the cottage. The guilders were once more safely locked in the big chest, and Dame Brinker and the children were faring sumptuously on meat and white bread and wine. So the mother, in the joy of her heart, told them the story of the watch as far as she deemed it prudent to divulge it. It was no more than fair, she thought, that the poor things should know, after keeping the secret so safe, ever since they had been old enough to know anything. End of chapter.
Chapter 43 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 43. A Discovery. The next sun brought a busy day to the Brinkers. In the first place, the news of the 1,000 guilders had, of course, to be told to the father. Such tidings as that surely could not harm him. Then, while Gretel was diligently obeying her mother's injunction to clean the place fresh as a new brewing, Hans and the dame sallied forth to revel in the purchasing of peat and provisions. Hans was careless and contented. The dame was filled with delightful anxieties caused by the unreasonable demands of 10,000 guilders' worth of new wants that had sprung up like mushrooms in a single night. The happy woman talked so largely to Hans on their way to Amsterdam, and brought back such little bundles after all, that he scratched his bewildered head as he leaned against the chimney-piece, wondering whether, bigger the pouch, tighter the string, was in Jacob Katz, and therefore true, or whether he had dreamed it when he lay in a fever. "What thinking on, Big Eyes?" chirruped his mother, half reading his thoughts as she bustled about, preparing the dinner. "What thinking on? Why, Raff, would you believe it? The child thought to carry half Amsterdam back on his head. Bless us! He would have brought us as much coffee as would have filled this fire-pot. No, no, my lad, says I, no time for leaks when the ship is rich laden. And then how he stared, aye, just as he stares this minute. Hoot, lad, fly around a mite. You'll grow to the chimney-place with your staring and wondering. Now, Raff, here's your chair at the head of the table, where it should be, for there's a man to the house now. I'd say it to the king's face. Aye, that's the way. Lean on Hans. There's a strong staff for you. Growing like a weed, too, and it seems only yesterday since he was toddling. Sit by, my man, sit by.
Can you call to mind, Fro? Said Raff, settling himself cautiously in the big chair. The wonderful music-box that cheered your working in the big house at Heidelberg?
Aye, that I can, answered the dame. 3 turns of a brass key, and the witchy thing would send the music fairly running up and down one's back. I remember it well. But Raff, growing solemn in an instant, you would never throw our guilders away for a thing like that.
No, no, not I, Fro, for the good Lord has already given me a music-box without pay.
All 3 cast quick, frightened glances at one another and at Raff. Were his wits on the wing again?
Aye, and a music-box that 50 pouchful would not buy from me, insisted Raff. And it's set going by the turn of a mop-handle, and it slips and glides around the room, everywhere in a flash, carrying the music about till you'd swear the birds were back again.
"Holy Saint Bavon!" screeched the dame. "What's in the man?"
"Comfort and joy, Fro, that's what's in him. Ask Gretel. Ask my little music-box, Gretel,
if your man has lacked comfort and joy this day."
"Not he, mother," laughed Gretel. "He's been my music-box, too. We sang together half the time you were gone."
"Aye, so," said the dame, greatly relieved. "Now, Hans, you'll never get through with a piece like that. But never mind, chick, thou hast had a long fasting. Here, Gretel, take another slice of the sausage. It'll put blood in your cheeks."
Oh, mother,"
laughed Gretel, eagerly holding forth her platter. "Blood doesn't grow in girls' cheeks. You mean roses. Isn't it roses, Hans?" While Hans was hastily swallowing a mammoth mouthful in order to give a suitable reply to this poetic appeal, Dame Brinker settled the matter with a quick, "Well, roses or blood, it's all one to me, so the red finds its way on your sunny face. It's enough for mother to get pale and weary-looking without—"
"Hoot, Frau," spoke up Raff hastily, "thou art fresher and rosier this minute than both our chicks put together."
This remark, though not bearing very strong testimony to the clearness of Raff's newly awakened intellect, nevertheless afforded the dame immense satisfaction. The meal accordingly went on in the most delightful manner. After dinner the affair of the watch was talked over and the mysterious initials duly discussed. Hans had just pushed back his stool, intending to start at once for Mynheer van Holp's, and his mother had risen to put the watch away in its old hiding-place, when they heard the sound of wheels upon the frozen ground. Someone knocked at the door, opening it at the same time.
"Come in,"
stammered Dame Brinker, hastily trying to hide the watch in her bosom.
"Oh, it is you, Mynheer. Good day. The father is nearly well, as you see. It's a poor place to greet you in, Mynheer, and the dinner not cleared away."
Dr. Bookman scarcely noticed the dame's apology. He was evidently in haste.
"Ahem!" he exclaimed. "Not needed here, I perceive. The patient is mending fast."
"Well he may, Mynheer," cried the dame, "for only last night we found 1,000 guilders that's been lost to us these 10 years.
Dr. Bookman opened his eyes.
"Yes, Mynheer," said Raff. "I bid the Vrouw tell you, though it's to be held a secret among us, for I see you can keep your lips closed as well as any man."
The doctor scowled. He never liked personal remarks.
"Now, Mynheer," continued Raff, "you can take your rightful pay. God knows you have earned it, if bringing such a poor tool back to the world and his family can be called a service. Tell the Vrouw what's to pay, Mynheer. She will hand out the sum right willingly."
"Tut, tut," said the doctor kindly. "Say nothing about money. I can find plenty of such pay any time, but gratitude comes seldom. That boy's thank you," he added, nodding sideways toward Hans, "was pay enough for me."
"Like enough you have a boy of your own," said Dame Brinker, quite delighted to see the great man becoming so sociable.
Dr. Bookman's good nature vanished at once. He gave a growl, at least it seemed so to Gretel, but made no actual reply.
"Do not think the Vrouw meddlesome, Mynheer," said Raff. "She has been sore touched of late about a lad whose folks have gone away, none knows where, and I had a message for them from the young gentleman."
"The name was Boomphoffen," said the dame eagerly. "Do you know aught of the family, Mynheer?"
The doctor's reply was brief and gruff.
"Yes, a troublesome set. They went long since to America."
"It might be, Raff," persisted Dame Brinker timidly, "that the maester knows somebody in that country, though I'm told they are mostly savages over there. If he could get the watch to the Boomphoffens with the poor lad's message, it would be a most blessed thing."
"Tut, Vrouw, why pester the good maester, and dying men and women wanting him everywhere? How do you know you have the true name?"
"I'm sure of it," she replied. "They had a son Lambert, and there's an L for Lambert, and a B for Boomphoffen, on the back, though, to be sure, there's an odd J, too, but the maester can look for himself." So saying, she drew forth the watch.
"L.J.B.!"
cried Dr. Bookman, springing toward her. Why attempt to describe the scene that followed? I need only say that the lad's message was delivered to his father at last, delivered while the great surgeon was sobbing like a little child.
"Lawrence! My Lawrence!"
he cried, gazing with yearning eyes at the watch as he held it tenderly in his palm.
"Ah, if I had but known sooner! Lawrence, a homeless wanderer! Great heaven! He may be suffering, dying at this moment. Think, man, where is he? Where did my boy say that the letter must be sent?"
Raff shook his head sadly. "Think," implored the doctor. Surely the memory so lately awakened through his aid could not refuse to serve him in a moment like this.
"It is all gone, my dear," sighed Raff.
Hans, forgetting distinctions of rank and station, forgetting everything but that his good friend was in trouble, threw his arms around the doctor's neck. "I can find your son, mynheer. If alive, he is somewhere. The earth is not so very large. I will devote every day of my life to the search. Mother can spare me now. You are rich, mynheer. Send me where you will." Gretel began to cry. It was right for Hans to go, but how could they ever live without him? Dr. Bookman made no reply, neither did he push Hans away. His eyes were fixed anxiously upon Raff Brinker. Suddenly he lifted the watch, and with trembling eagerness attempted to open it. Its stiffened spring yielded at last, the case flew open, disclosing a watch-paper in the back bearing a group of blue forget-me-nots. Raff, seeing a shade of intense disappointment pass over the doctor's face, hastened to say,
"There was something else in it, mynheer, but the young gentleman tore it out before he handed it to me. I saw him kiss it as he put it away." "It was his mother's picture," moaned the doctor. "She died when he was 10 years old. Thank God, the boy had not forgotten. Both dead. It is impossible," he cried, starting up. "My boy is alive. You shall hear his story. Lawrence acted as my assistant. By mistake, he portioned out the wrong medicine for one of my patients, a deadly poison, but it was never administered, for I discovered the error in time. The man died that day. I was detained with other bad cases until the next evening. When I reached home, my boy was gone. Poor Lawrence!" sobbed the doctor, breaking down completely. "Never to hear from me through all these years! His message disregarded! Oh, what he must have suffered!"
Dame Brinker ventured to speak. Anything was better than to see the maester cry. "It is a mercy to know the young gentleman was innocent. Ah, how he fretted! Telling you, Raff, that his crime was like unto murder. It was sending the wrong physic that he meant. Crime, indeed! Why, our own Gretel might have done that. Like enough the poor young gentleman heard that the man was dead. That's why he ran, mynheer. He said, you know, Raff, that he never could come back to Holland again unless—" She hesitated. "Ah, your honor, 10 years is a dreary time to be waiting to hear from—"
"Sh, Fro," said Raff sharply. "Waiting to hear," the doctor groaned, "and I, like a fool, sitting stubbornly at home, thinking that he had abandoned me. I never dreamed, Brinker, that the boy had discovered the mistake. I believed it was youthful folly, ingratitude, love of adventure that sent him away. My poor, poor Lawrence!"
"But you know all now, mynheer," whispered Hans. "You know he was innocent of wrong, that he loved you and his dead mother. We will find him. You shall see him again, dear maester."
"God bless you," said Dr. Bookman, seizing the boy's hand.
It may be as you say. I shall try. I shall try. And, Brinker, if ever the faintest gleam of recollection concerning him should come to you, you will send me word at once.
Indeed we will, cried all but Hans, whose silent promise would have satisfied the doctor even had the others not spoken.
Your boy's eyes, he said, turning to Dame Brinker, are strangely like my son's. The first time I met him, it seemed that Lawrence himself was looking at me.
"Aye, mynheer," replied the mother proudly, "I have marked that you were much drawn to the child."
For a few moments the maester seemed lost in thought. Then, arousing himself, he spoke in a new voice. "Forgive me, Ralph Brinker, for this tumult. Do not feel distressed on my account. I leave your house today a happier man than I have been for many a long year. Shall I take the watch?"
"Certainly you must, mynheer. It was your son's wish."
"Even so," responded the doctor, regarding his treasure with a queer frown, for his face could not throw off its bad habits in an hour. "Even so. And now I must be gone. No medicine is needed by my patient. Only peace and cheerfulness, and both are here in plenty. Heaven bless you, my good friends. I shall ever be grateful to you."
"May heaven bless you too, mynheer, and may you soon find the young gentleman," said Dame Brinker earnestly, after hurriedly wiping her eyes upon the corner of her apron. Ralph uttered a hearty
"Amen,"
and Gretel threw such a wistful, eager glance at the doctor that he patted her head as he turned to leave the cottage. Hans went out also. "When I can serve you, mynheer, I am ready."
"Very well, boy," replied Dr. Bookman with peculiar mildness. "Tell them within to say nothing of what has just happened. Meantime, Hans, when you are with your father, watch his mood. You have tact. At any moment he may suddenly be able to tell us more."
"Trust me for that, mynheer."
"Good day, my boy," cried the doctor as he sprang into his stately coach.
"Aha," thought Hans as it rolled away, "the maester has more life in him than I thought." End of chapter.
Chapter 44 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 44, The Race. The 20th of December came at last, bringing with it the perfection of winter weather. All over the level landscape lay the warm sunlight. It tried its power on lake, canal, and river, but the ice flashed defiance and showed no sign of melting. The very weathercocks stood still to enjoy the sight. This gave the windmills a holiday. Nearly all the past week they had been whirling briskly. Now, being rather out of breath, they rocked lazily in the clear, still air. Catch a windmill working when the weathercocks have nothing to do. There was an end to grinding, crushing, and sawing for that day. It was a good thing for the millers near Brook. Long before noon they concluded to take in their sails and go to the race. Everybody would be there. Already the north side of the frozen eye was bordered with eager spectators. The news of the great skating match had traveled far and wide. Men, women, and children in holiday attire were flocking toward the spot. Some wore furs and wintry cloaks or shawls, but many, consulting their feelings rather than the almanac, were dressed as for an October day. The site selected for the race was a faultless plain of ice near Amsterdam, on that great arm of the Zuider Zee, which Dutchmen, of course, must call the Eye. The townspeople turned out in large numbers. Strangers to the city deemed it a fine chance to see what was to be seen. Many a peasant from the northward had wisely chosen the 20th as the day for the next city trading. It seemed that everybody, young and old, who had wheels, skates, or feet at command, had hastened to the scene. There were the gentry in their coaches, dressed like Parisians, fresh from the boulevards, Amsterdam children in charity uniforms, girls from the Roman Catholic orphan house in sable gowns and white headbands, boys from the burgher asylum with their black tights and short-skirted harlequin coats. This is not said in derision. Both the boys and girls of this institution wear garments quartered in red and black alternately. By making the dress thus conspicuous, the children are, in a measure, deterred from wrongdoing while going about the city. The burgher orphan asylum affords a comfortable home to several hundred boys and girls. Holland is famous for its charitable institutions. There were old-fashioned gentlemen in cocked hats and velvet knee breeches, old-fashioned ladies, too, in stiff quilted skirts and bodices of dazzling brocade. These were accompanied by servants bearing foot-stoves and cloaks. There were the peasant folk arrayed in every possible Dutch costume, shy young rustics in brazen buckles, simple village maidens concealing their flaxen hair under fillets of gold, women whose long, narrow aprons were stiff with embroidery, women with short corkscrew curls hanging over their foreheads, women with shaved heads and close-fitting caps, and women in striped skirts and windmill bonnets, men in leather, in homespun, in velvet, and in broadcloth, burghers in model European attire, and burghers in short jackets, wide trousers, and steeple-crowned hats. There were beautiful Friesland girls in wooden shoes and coarse petticoats, with solid gold crescents encircling their heads, finished at each temple with a golden rosette and hung with lace a century old. Some wore necklaces, pendants, and earrings of the purest gold. Many were content with gilt or even with brass, but it is not an uncommon thing for a Friesland woman to have all the family treasure in her headgear. More than one rustic lass displayed the value of 2,000 guilders upon her head that day. Scattered throughout the crowd were peasants from the island or Marken, with sabots, black stockings, and the widest of breeches, also women from Marken with short blue petticoats and black jackets, gaily figured in front. They wore red sleeves, white aprons, and a cap like a bishop's mitre over their golden hair. The children often were as quaint and odd-looking as their elders. In short, one-third of the crowd seemed to have stepped bodily from a collection of Dutch paintings. Everywhere could be seen tall women and stumpy men, lively-faced girls, and youths whose expression never changed from sunrise to sunset. There seemed to be at least one specimen from every known town in Holland. There were Utrecht water-bearers, Gouda cheesemakers, Delft pottery men, Schiedam distillers, Amsterdam diamond cutters, Rotterdam merchants, dried-up herring packers, and two sleepy-eyed shepherds from Texel. Every man of them had his pipe and tobacco pouch. Some carried what might be called the smoker's complete outfit: a pipe, tobacco, a pricker with which to clean the tube, a silver net for protecting the bowl, and a box of the strongest brimstone matches. A true Dutchman, you must remember, is rarely without his pipe on any possible occasion. He may for a moment neglect to breathe, but when the pipe is forgotten, he must be dying indeed. There were no such sad cases here. Wreaths of smoke were rising from every possible quarter. The more fantastic the smoke wreath, the more placid and solemn the smoker. "Look at those boys and girls on stilts. That is a good idea. They can see over the heads of the tallest. It is strange to see those little bodies high in the air, carried about on mysterious legs. They have such a resolute look on their round faces. What wonder that nervous old gentlemen with tender feet wince and tremble while the long-legged little monsters stride past them? You will read in certain books that the Dutch are quiet people. So they are, generally. But listen. Did you ever hear such a din? All made up of human voices. No, The horses are helping somewhat, and the fiddles are squeaking pitifully. How it must pain fiddles to be tuned. But the mass of the sound comes from the great vox humana that belongs to a crowd. That queer little dwarf going about with a heavy basket, winding in and out among the people, helps not a little. You can hear his shrill cry above all the other sounds, "Pipen und Tabak! Pipen und Tabak!" Another, his big brother, though evidently some years younger, is selling doughnuts and bonbons. He is calling on all pretty children far and near to come quickly, or the cakes will be gone. You know quite a number among the spectators. High up in yonder pavilion, erected upon the border of the ice, are some persons whom you have seen very lately. In the center is Madame von Gleck. It is her birthday, you remember. She has the post of honor. There is Mynheer von Gleck, whose meerschaum has not really grown fast to his lips, it only appears so. There are grandfather and grandmother, whom you met at the St. Nicholas fete. All the children are with them. It is so mild they have brought even the baby. The poor little creature is swathed very much after the manner of an Egyptian mummy, but it can crow with delight, and, when the band is playing, open and shut its animated mittens in perfect time to the music. Grandfather, with his pipe and spectacles and fur cap, makes quite a picture as he holds baby upon his knee. Perched high upon their canopied platforms, the party can see all that is going on. No wonder the ladies look complacently at the glassy ice. With a stove for a footstool, one might sit cozily beside the North Pole. There is a gentleman with them, who somewhat resembles St. Nicholas, as he appeared to the young von Glecks on the 5th of December. But the saint had a flowing white beard, and this face is as smooth as a pippin. His saintship was larger around the body, too, and, between ourselves, he had a pair of thimbles in his mouth, which this gentleman certainly has not. It cannot be St. Nicholas, after all. Nearby, in the next pavilion, sit the Van Holps with their son and daughter, the Van Gents, from The Hague. Peter's sister is not one to forget her promises. She has brought bouquets of exquisite hothouse flowers for the winners. These pavilions, and there are others besides, have all been erected since daylight. That semicircular one, containing Mynheer Korbes's family, is very pretty, and proves that the Hollanders are quite skilled at tent-making. But I like the Van Glecks best, the center one, striped red and white, and hung with evergreens. The one with the blue flags contains the musicians. Those pagoda-like affairs, decked with seashells and streamers of every possible hue, are the judges' stands, and those columns and flagstaffs upon the ice mark the limit of the race-course. The two white columns twined with green, connected at the top by that long, floating strip of drapery, form the starting point. Those flagstaffs, half a mile off, stand at each end of the boundary line, which is cut sufficiently deep to be distinct to the skaters, though not deep enough to trip them when they turn to come back to the starting point. The air is so clear that it seems scarcely possible that the columns and the flagstaffs are so far apart. Of course, the judges' stands are but little nearer together. Half a mile on the ice, when the atmosphere is like this, is but a short distance after all, especially when fenced with a living chain of spectators. The music has commenced. How melody seems to enjoy itself in the open air! The fiddles have forgotten their agony, and everything is harmonious. Until you look at the blue tent, it seems that the music springs from the sunshine. It is so boundless, so joyous. Only when you see the staid-faced musicians do you realize the truth. Where are the racers? All assembled together near the white columns. It is a beautiful sight. 40 boys and girls in picturesque attire darting with electric swiftness in and out among each other, or sailing in pairs and triplets, beckoning, chatting, whispering in the fullness of youthful glee. A few careful ones are soberly tightening their straps, others halting on one leg, with flushed, eager faces, suddenly cross the suspected skate over their knee, give it an examining shake, and dart off again. One and all are possessed with the spirit of motion. They cannot stand still. Their skates are a part of them, and every runner seems bewitched. Holland is the place for skaters, after all. Where else can nearly every boy and girl perform feats on the ice that would attract a crowd if seen in Central Park? Look at Ben! He is really astonishing the natives. No easy thing to do in the Netherlands. Save your strength, Ben. You will need it soon. Now other boys are trying. Ben is surpassed already. Such jumping, such poising, such spinning, such India rubber exploits generally. That boy with a red cap is the lion now. His back is a watch spring. His body is cork. No, it is iron, or it would snap at that. He's a bird, a top, a rabbit, a corkscrew, a sprite, a flesh ball, all in an instant. When you think he's erect, he is down. When you think he is down, he is up. He drops his glove on the ice and turns a somersault as he picks it up. Without stopping, he snatches the cap from Jacob Poot's astonished head and claps it back again, hindside before. Lookers on hurrah and laugh. Foolish boy, it is Arctic weather under your feet, but more than temperate overhead. Big drops already are rolling down your forehead. Superb skater as you are, you may lose the race. A French traveller, standing with a notebook in his hand, sees our English friend Ben buy a doughnut of the dwarf's brother and eat it. Thereupon he writes in his notebook that the Dutch take enormous mouthfuls and universally are fond of potatoes boiled in molasses. There are some familiar faces near the white columns. Lambert, Ludwig, Peter, and Karl are all there, cool and in good skating order. Hans is not far off. Evidently he is going to join in the race, for his skates are on, the very pair that he sold for 7 guilders. He had soon suspected that his fairy godmother was the mysterious friend who bought them. This settled, he had boldly charged her with the deed, and she, knowing well that all her little savings had been spent in the purchase, had not had the face to deny it. Through the fairy godmother, too, he had been rendered amply able to buy them back again. Therefore Hans is to be in the race. Karl is more indignant than ever about it, but as 3 other peasant boys have entered, Hans is not alone. 20 boys and 20 girls. The latter, by this time, are standing in front, braced for the start, for they are to have the first run. Hilda, Richie, and Katrinka are among them. 2 or 3 bend hastily to give a last pull at their skate straps. It is pretty to see them stamp, to be sure that all is firm. Hilda is speaking pleasantly to a graceful little creature in a red jacket and a new brown petticoat. Why, it is Gretel! What a difference those pretty shoes make, and the skirt and the new cap! Annie Bowman is there, too. Even Jansoon Kolp's sister has been admitted, but Jansoon himself has been voted out by the directors because he killed the stork, and only last summer was caught in the act of robbing a bird's nest, a legal offense in Holland. This Jansoon Kolp, you see, was... There, I cannot tell the story just now. The race is about to commence. 20 girls are formed in a line. The music has ceased. A man, whom we shall call the crier, stands between the columns and the first judge's stand. He reads the rules in a loud voice. The girls and boys are to race in turn until 1 girl and 1 boy have beaten 2x. They are to start in a line from the united columns, skate to the flagstaff line, turn, and then come back to the starting point, thus making 1 mile at each run. A flag is waved from the judge's stand. Madame von Gleck rises in her pavilion. She leans forward with a white handkerchief in her hand. When she drops it, a bugler is to give the signal for them to start. The handkerchief is fluttering to the ground. Hark! They are off! No, back again. Their line was not true in passing the judge's stand. The signal is repeated. Off again! No mistake this time. Whew! How fast they go! The multitude is quiet for an instant, absorbed in eager, breathless watching. Cheers spring up along the line of spectators. Huzzah! 5 girls are ahead. Who comes flying back from the boundary mark? We cannot tell. Something red, that is all. There is a blue spot flitting near it, and a dash of yellow nearer still. Spectators at this end of the line strain their eyes and wish they had taken their post nearer the flagstaff. The wave of cheers is coming back again. Now we can see. Katrinka is ahead. She passes the Van Holp pavilion. The next is Madame van Gleck's. That leaning figure gazing from it is a magnet. Hilda shoots past Katrinka, waving her hand to her mother as she passes. 2 others are close now, whizzing on like arrows. What is that flash of red and gray? Hurrah! It is Gretel! She too waves her hand, but toward no gay pavilion. The crowd is cheering, but she hears only her father's voice. Well done, little Gretel! Soon Katrinka, with a quick merry laugh, shoots past Hilda. The girl in yellow is gaining now. She passes them all except Gretel. The judges lean forward without seeming to lift their eyes from their watches. Cheer after cheer fills the air. Their very columns seem rocking. Gretel has passed them. She has won. Gretel Brinker, 1 mile, shouts the crier. The judges nod. They write something upon a tablet which each holds in his hand. While the girls are resting, some crowding eagerly around our frightened little Gretel, some standing aside in high disdain, the boys form a line. Mynheer van Gleck drops the handkerchief this time. The buglers give a vigorous blast. The boys have started. Halfway already! Did you ever see the like? 300 legs flashing by in an instant. But there are only 20 boys. No matter, there were hundreds of legs, I am sure. Where are they now? There is such a noise, one gets bewildered. What are the people laughing at? Oh, at that fat boy in the rear. See him go? See him? He'll be down in an instant. No, he won't. I wonder if he knows he is all alone. The other boys are nearly at the boundary line. Yes, he knows it. He stops. He wipes his hot face. He takes off his cap and looks about him. Better to give up with a good grace. He has made 100 friends by that hearty, astonished laugh. Good Jacob Poot! The fine fellow is already among the spectators, gazing as eagerly as the rest. A cloud of feathery ice flies from the heels of the skaters as they bring to and turn at the flagstaffs. Something black is coming now. One of the boys. It is all we know. He has touched the vox humana stop of the crowd. It fairly roars. Now they come nearer. We can see the red cap. There's Ben. There's Peter. There's Hans. Hans is ahead. Young Madame von Gend almost crushes the flowers in her hand. She has been quite sure that Peter would be first. Karl Schummel is next, then Ben, and the youth with the red cap. A tall figure darts from among them. He passes the red cap, he passes Ben, then Karl. Now it is an even race between him and Hans. Madame von Gend catches her breath. It is Peter! He is ahead! Hans shoots past him. Hilda's eyes fill with tears. Peter must beat. Annie's eyes flash proudly. Gretel gazes with clasped hands. 4 strokes more will take her brother to the columns. He is there! Yes, but so was young Schummel just a second before. At the last second, Karl, gathering his powers, had whizzed between them and passed the goal. Karl Schummel, 1 mile! Shouts the crier. Soon Madame von Gleck rises again. The falling handkerchief starts the bugle, and the bugle, using its voice as a bowstring, shoots off 20 girls like so many arrows. It is a beautiful sight, but one has not long to look. Before we can fairly distinguish them, they are far in the distance. This time they are close upon one another. It is hard to say, as they come speeding back from the flagstaff, which will reach the columns first. There are new faces among the foremost, eager, glowing faces, unnoticed before. Katrinka is there, and Hilda, but Gretel and Ritchie are in the rear. Gretel is wavering, but when Ritchie passes her, she starts forward afresh. Now they are nearly beside Katrinka.
Hilda is still in advance. She is almost home. She has not faltered since that bugle note sent her flying. Like an arrow still, she is speeding toward the goal. Cheer after cheer rises in the air. Peter is silent, but his eyes shine like stars. Huzzah! Huzzah! The crier's voice is heard again. Hilda van Gleck, 1 mile! A loud murmur of approval runs through the crowd, catching the music in its course, till all seems one sound, with a glad rhythmic throbbing in its depths. When the flag waves, all is still. Once more the bugle blows a terrific blast. It sends off the boys like chaff before the wind, dark chaff, I admit, and in big pieces. It is whisked around at the flagstaff, driven faster yet by the cheers and shouts along the line. We begin to see what is coming. There are 3 boys in advance this time, and all abreast. Hans, Peter, and Lambert. Carl soon breaks the ranks, rushing through with a whiff. Fly, Hans! Fly, Peter! Don't let Carl beat again! Carl the bitter, Carl the insolent. Von Monen is flagging, but you are strong as ever. Hans and Peter, Peter and Hans, which is foremost? We love them both. We scarcely care which is the fleeter. Hilda, Annie, and Gretel, seated upon the long crimson bench, can remain quiet no longer. They spring to their feet, so different and yet one in eagerness. Hilda instantly reseats herself. None shall know how interested she is. None shall know how anxious, how filled with one hope. Shut your eyes, then, Hilda. Hide your face, rippling with joy. Peter has beaten.
Peter van Hope, 1 mile, calls the crier.
The same buzz of excitement as before. While the judges take notes, the same throbbing of music through the din. But something is different. A little crowd presses close about some object near the column. Carl has fallen. He is not hurt, though somewhat stunned. If he were less sullen, he would find more sympathy in these warm young hearts. As it is, they forget him as soon as he is fairly on his feet again. The girls are to skate their 3rd mile. How resolute the little maidens look as they stand in a line. Some are solemn with a sense of responsibility. Some wear a smile half bashful, half provoked, but one air of determination pervades them all. This 3rd mile may decide the race. Still, if neither Gretel nor Hilda wins, there is yet a chance among the rest for the silver skates. Each girl feels sure that this time she will accomplish the distance in 1/2 of the time. How they stamp to try their runners! How nervously they examine each strap! How erect they stand at last, every eye upon Madame von Gleck! The bugle thrills through them again. With quivering eagerness they spring forward, bending, but in perfect balance. Each flashing stroke seems longer than the last. Now they are skimming off in the distance. Again the eager straining of eyes, again the shouts and cheering, again the thrill of excitement as, after a few moments, 4 or 5, in advance of the rest, comes speeding back, nearer, nearer to the white columns. Who is first? Not Richie, Katrinka, Annie, nor Hilda, nor the girl in yellow, but Gretel. Gretel, the fleetest sprite of a girl that ever skated. She was but playing in the earlier races. Now she is in earnest, or rather, something within her has determined to win. That lithe little form makes no effort, but it cannot stop. Not until the goal is passed. In vain the crier lifts his voice. He cannot be heard. He has no news to tell. It is already ringing through the crowd. Gretel has won the silver skates. Like a bird she has flown over the ice. Like a bird she looks about her in a timid, startled way. She longs to dart to the sheltered nook where her father and mother stand. But Hans is beside her. The girls are crowding round. Hilda's kind, joyous voice breathes in her ear. From that hour, none will despise her. Goose girl or not, Gretel stands acknowledged queen of the skaters. With natural pride, Hans turns to see if Peter van Holp is witnessing his sister's triumph. Peter is not looking toward them at all. He is kneeling, bending his troubled face low, and working hastily at his skate strap. Hans is beside him at once. "Are you in trouble, mynheer?" "Ah, Hans, is that you? Yes, my fun is over. I tried to tighten my strap, to make a new hole, and this botheration of a knife has cut it nearly in two." "Mynheer," said Hans, at the same time pulling off a skate, "you must use my strap."
"Not I, indeed, Hans Brinker," cried Peter, looking up, "though I thank you warmly. Go to your post, my friend. The bugle will be sounding in another minute."
"Mynheer," pleaded Hans in a husky voice, "you have called me your friend. Take the strap, quick. There is not an instant to lose. I shall not skate this time. Indeed, I am out of practice. Mynheer, you must take it." And Hans, blind and deaf to any remonstrance, slipped his strap into Peter's skate and implored him to put it on.
"Come, Peter," cried Lambert from the line, "we are waiting for you."
"For madam's sake," pleaded Hans, "be quick. She is motioning to you to join the racers. There, the skate is almost on. Quick, mynheer, fasten it. I could not possibly win. The race lies between Master Schummel and yourself."
"You are a noble fellow, Hans," cried Peter,
yielding at last. He sprang to his post just as the white handkerchief fell to the ground. The bugle sends forth its blast, loud, clear, and ringing. Off go the boys.
"Mein Gott," cries a tough old fellow from Delft, "they beat everything, these Amsterdam youngsters. See them!"
"See them, indeed. They are winged Mercuries, every one of them. What mad errand are they on? Ah, I know, they are hunting Peter van Holp. He is some fleet-footed runaway from Olympus. Mercury and his troop of winged cousins are in full chase. They will catch him. Now Carl is the runaway. The pursuit grows furious. Ben is foremost. The chase turns in a cloud of mist. It is coming this way. Who is hunted now? Mercury himself. It is Peter. Peter van Holp. Fly, Peter. Hans is watching you. He is sending all his fleetness, all his strength into your feet. Your mother and sister are pale with eagerness. Hilda is trembling and dares not look up. Fly, Peter! The crowd has not gone deranged. It is only cheering. The pursuers are close upon you. Touch the white column. It beckons. It is reeling before you. It...
Huzzah! Huzzah! Peter has won the silver skates.
Peter van Holp! Shouted the crier. But who heard him? Peter van Holp! Shouted a hundred voices, for he was the favorite boy of the place. Huzzah! Huzzah!
Now the music was resolved to be heard. It struck up a lively air, then a tremendous march. The spectators, thinking something new was about to happen, deigned to listen and to look. The races formed in single file. Peter, being tallest, stood first. Gretel, the smallest of all, took her place at the end. Hans, who had borrowed a strap from the cake boy, was near the head. Three gaily twined arches were placed at intervals upon the river facing the Van Gleck pavilion. Skating slowly, and in perfect time to the music, the boys and girls moved forward, led on by Peter. It was beautiful to see the bright procession glide along like a living creature. It curved and doubled, and drew its graceful length in and out among the arches. Whichever way Peter, the head, went, the body was sure to follow. Sometimes it steered direct for the center arch, then, as if seized with a new impulse, turned away and curled itself about the first one, then unwound slowly and, bending low, with quick, snake-like curvings, crossed the river, passing at length through the furthest arch. When the music was slow, the procession seemed to crawl like a thing afraid. It grew livelier, and the creature darted forward with a spring, gliding rapidly among the arches, in and out, curling, twisting, turning, never losing form until, at the shrill call of the bugle rising above the music, it suddenly resolved itself into boys and girls standing in a double semicircle before Madame von Gleck's pavilion. Peter and Gretel stand in the center in advance of the others. Madame von Gleck rises majestically. Gretel trembles, but feels that she must look at the beautiful lady. She cannot hear what is said, There is such a buzzing all around her. She is thinking that she ought to try and make a curtsy, such as her mother makes to the Maester, when suddenly something so dazzling is placed in her hand that she gives a cry of joy. Then she ventures to look about her. Peter, too, has something in his hands.
"Oh, oh, how splendid!"
she cries, and "Oh, how splendid!" is echoed as far as people can see.
Meantime the silver skates flash in the sunshine, throwing dashes of light upon those two happy faces.
Mevrouw von Gent sends a little messenger with her bouquets, one for Hilda, one for Karl, and others for Peter and Gretel. At sight of the flowers the queen of the skaters becomes uncontrollable. With a bright stare of gratitude she gathers skates and bouquets in her apron, hugs them to her bosom, and darts off to search for her father and mother in the scattering crowd. End of chapter.
Chapter 45 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or the Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 45. Joy in the Cottage. Perhaps you were surprised to learn that Raff and his Frau were at the skating race. You would have been more so had you been with them on the evening of that merry 20th of December. To see the Brinker cottage standing sulkily alone on the frozen marsh, with its bulgy, rheumatic-looking walls and its slouched hat of a roof pulled far over its eyes, one would never suspect that a lively scene was passing within. Without, nothing was left of the day but a low line of blaze at the horizon. A few venturesome clouds had already taken fire, and others, with their edges burning, were lost in the gathering smoke. A stray gleam of sunshine slipping down from the willow stump crept stealthily under the cottage. It seemed to feel that the inmates would give it welcome if it could only get near them. The room under which it hid was as clean could be. The very cracks in the rafters were polished. Delicious odors filled the air. A huge peat fire upon the hearth sent flashes of harmless lightning at the somber walls. It played in turn upon the great leather Bible, upon Gretel's closet bed, the household things upon their pegs, and the beautiful silver skates and the flowers upon the table. Dame Brinker's honest face shone and twinkled in the changing light. Gretel and Hans, with arms entwined, were leaning against the fireplace, laughing merrily, and Raff Brinker was dancing. I do not mean that he was pirouetting or cutting a pigeon wing, either of which would have been entirely too undignified for the father of a family. I simply affirm that while they were chatting pleasantly together, Raff suddenly sprang from his seat, snapped his fingers, and performed two or three flourishes very much like the climax of a Highland fling. Next he caught his Frau in his arms and fairly lifted her from the ground in his delight. "Huzzah!" he cried. "I have it! I have it! It's Thomas Higgs. That's the name. It came upon me like a flash. Write it down, lad. Write it down." Someone knocked at the door. "It's the Maester!" cried the delighted dame. "Gerde Gunst! How things come to pass!" Mother and children came in merry collision as they rushed to open the door. It was not the doctor after all, but three boys, Peter van Hope, Lambert, and Ben. "Good evening, young gentlemen," said Dame Brinker, so happy and proud that she would scarcely have been surprised at a visit from the king himself. "Good evening, Jufvrouw," said the trio, making magnificent bows. "Dear me," thought Dame Brinker as she bobbed up and down like a churn dasher, "it's lucky I learned to curtsy at Heidelberg." Raff was content to return the boys' salutations with a respectful nod. "Pray be seated, young masters," said the dame as Gretel bashfully thrust a stool at them. "There's a lack of chairs, as you see,
but this one by the fire is at your service, and if you don't mind the hardness, that oak chest is as good a seat as the best. That's right, Hans, pull it out." By the time the boys were seated to the dame's satisfaction, Peter, acting as a spokesman, had explained that they were going to attend a lecture at Amsterdam, and had stopped on the way to return Hans's strap. "Oh, Mynheer," cried Hans earnestly, "it is too much trouble. I am very sorry." "No trouble at all, Hans. I could have waited for you to come to your work tomorrow had I not wished to call. And Hans, talking of your work, my father is much pleased with it. A carver by trade could not have done it better. He would like to have the south arbor ornamented also, but I told him you were going to school again." "Aye," put in Ralph Brinker emphatically, "Hans must go to school at once, and Gretel as well. That is true." "I am glad to hear you say so," responded Peter, turning toward the father, "and very glad to know that you are again a well man."
"Yes, young master, a well man, and able to work as steady as ever, thank God."
Here Hans hastily wrote something on the edge of a time-worn almanac that hung by the chimney-place.
"Aye, that's right, lad, set it down. Figs, wigs, alack, alack," cried Raff in great dismay. "It's gone again."
"All right, father," said Hans. "The name's down now in black and white. Here, look at it, father. Mayhap the rest will come to you. If we had the place as well, it would be complete." Then, turning to Peter, he said in a low tone, "I have an important errand in town, mynheer, and if—"
"Whist!" exclaimed the dame, lifting her hands. "Not to Amsterdam to-night, and you've owned your legs were aching under you. Nay, nay, it'll be soon enough to go at early daylight."
"Daylight, indeed," echoed Raff. "That would never do. Nay, maitje, he must go this hour."
The Fro looked for an instant as if Raff's recovery was becoming rather a doubtful benefit. Her word was no longer sole law in the house. Fortunately, the proverb, "humble wife is husband's boss," had taken deep root in her mind. Even as the dame pondered, it bloomed. "Very well, Raff," she said smilingly. "It is thy boy as well as mine. Ah, I've a troublesome house, young masters." Just then Peter drew a long strap from his pocket. Handing it to Hans, he said in an undertone, "I need not thank you for lending me this, Hans Brinker. Such boys as you do not ask for thanks. But I must say you did me a great kindness, and I am proud to acknowledge it."
"I did not know," he added laughingly, "until fairly in the race, how anxious I was to win."
Hans was glad to join in Peter's laugh. It covered his embarrassment and gave his face a chance to cool off a little. Honest, generous boys like Hans have such a stupid way of blushing when you least expect it.
"It was nothing, mynheer," said the dame, hastening to her son's relief. "The lad's whole soul was in having you win the race. I know it was." This helped matters beautifully. "Ah, mynheer," Hans hurried to say, "from the first start I felt stiff and strange on my feet. I was well out of it, so long as I had no chance of winning."
Peter looked rather distressed. "We may hold different opinions here. That part of the business troubles me. It is too late to mend it now, but it would be really a kindness to me if—" The rest of Peter's speech was uttered so confidentially that I cannot record it. Enough to say, Hans soon started back in dismay, and Peter, looking very much ashamed, stammered out something to the effect that he would keep them, since he won the race, but it was all wrong. Here Van Monen coughed, as if to remind Peter that lecture hour was approaching fast. At the same moment Ben laid something upon the table.
"Ah!" exclaimed Peter, "I forgot my other errand. Your sister ran off so quickly today that Madame van Gleck had no opportunity to give her the case for her skates."
"Shh!" said Dame Brinker, shaking her head reproachfully at Gretel. "She was a very rude girl, I'm sure." Secretly she was thinking that very few women had such a fine little daughter. "No, indeed," Peter laughed. "She did exactly the right thing. Ran home with her richly won treasures. Who would not? Don't let us detain you, Hans," he continued, turning around as he spoke. But Hans, who was eagerly watching his father, seemed to have forgotten their presence. Meantime, Raff, lost in thought, was repeating under his breath, "Thomas Higgs, Thomas Higgs, aye, that's the name. Alack, if I could but remember the place as well." The skate case was elegantly made of crimson morocco, ornamented with silver. If a fairy had designed its delicate tracery, they could not have been more daintily beautiful, for "The Fleetest" was written upon the cover in sparkling letters. It was lined with velvet, and in one corner was stamped the name and address of the maker. Gretel thanked Peter in her own simple way, then, being quite delighted and confused, and not knowing what else to do, she lifted the case, carefully examining it in every part. "It's made by Mynheer Birmingham," she said after a while, still blushing and holding it before her eyes. "Birmingham," replied Lambert von Monen. "That's the name of a place in England. Let me see it." "Ha, ha, ha," he laughed, holding the open case toward the firelight. "No wonder you thought so, but it's a slight mistake. The case was made at Birmingham, but the maker's name is in smaller letters. Huh, they're so small I can't read them." "Let me try," said Peter, leaning over his shoulder. "Why, man, it's perfectly distinct. It's T-H... it's T..." "Well," said Lambert triumphantly, "if you can read it so easily, let's hear it. T-H what?" "T-H... T-H... Oh, why, Thomas Higgs, to be sure," replied Peter, pleased to be able to decipher it at last. Then, feeling that they had been acting rather unceremoniously, he turned to Hans. Peter turned pale. What was the matter with the people? Raff and Hans had started up and were staring at him in glad amazement. Gretel looked wild. Dame Brinker, with an unlighted candle in her hand, was rushing about the room, crying, "Hans! Hans! Where's your hat? Oh, the Meister! Oh, the Meister!" "Birmingham! Higgs!" exclaimed Hans. "Did you say Higgs? We found him! I must be off!" "You see, young masters," the dame was panting, at the same time snatching Hans's hat from the bed, "you see, we know him. He's our..." "No, he isn't. I mean... Oh, Hans, you must go to Amsterdam this minute!" "Good night, mynheers," panted Hans, radiant with sudden joy. "Good night. You will excuse me. I must go. Birmingham, Higgs, Higgs, Birmingham." And seizing his hat from his mother and his skates from Gretel, he rushed from the cottage. What could the boys think but that the whole Brinker family had suddenly gone crazy? They bade an embarrassed good evening and turned to go, but Raff stopped them. "This Thomas Higgs, young masters, is a person." "Ah," exclaimed Peter, quite sure that Raff was the most crazy of all. "Yes, a person, a friend. We thought him dead. I hope it is the same man. In England, did you say?" "Yes, Birmingham," answered Peter. "It must be Birmingham in England." "I know the man," said Ben, addressing Lambert. "His factory is not 4 miles from our place. A queer fellow, still as an oyster. Doesn't seem at all like an Englishman. I've often seen him, a solemn-looking chap with magnificent eyes. He made a beautiful writing-case once for me to give Jenny on her birthday. Makes pocket-books, telescope cases, and all kinds of leather-work." As this was said in English, Van Monen, of course, translated it for the benefit of all concerned, noticing meanwhile that neither Raff nor his Frau looked very miserable, although Raff was trembling and the dame's eyes were swimming with tears.
You may believe that the doctor heard every word of the story when later in the evening he came driving back with Hans.
"The three young gentlemen had been gone some time," Dame Brinker said, "but like enough, by hurrying, it would be easy to find them coming out from the lecture, wherever that was."
"True," said Raff, nodding his head. "The Vrouw always hits upon the right thing. It would be well to see the young English gentleman, mynheer, before he forgets all about Thomas Higgs. It's a slippery name, do you see? One can't hold it safe a minute. It come upon me sudden and strong as a pile-driver, and my boy wrote it down. Aye, mynheer, I'd haste to talk with the English lad. He's seen your son many a time, only to think on it."
Dame Brinker took up the thread of the discourse. "You'll pick out the lad quick enough, mynheer, because he's in company with Peter Van Holp, and his hair curls up over his forehead like foreign folks, and if you hear him speak, he talks big and fast, only it's English, but that wouldn't be any hindrance to your honor."
The doctor had already lifted his hat to go. With a beaming face he muttered something about it being just like the young scamp to give himself a rascally English name, called Hans "my son," thereby making that young gentleman as happy as a lord, and left the cottage with very little ceremony, considering what a great maester he was. The grumbling coachman comforted himself by speaking his mind as he drove back to Amsterdam. Since the doctor was safely stowed away in the coach and could not hear a word, it was a fine time to say terrible things of folks who hadn't no manner of feeling for nobody, and who were always wanting the horses a dozen times of a night. End of chapter.
Chapter 46 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker or the Silver Skates by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 46. The Mysterious Disappearance of Thomas Higgs. Higgs's factory was a mine of delight for the gossips of Birmingham. It was a small building, but quite large enough to hold a mystery. Who the proprietor was, or where he came from, none could tell. He looked like a gentleman, that was certain, though everybody knew he had risen from an apprenticeship, and he could handle his pen like a writing-master. Years ago he had suddenly appeared in the place, a lad of 18, learned his trade faithfully, and risen in the confidence of his employer, been taken in as a partner soon after the time was up. Finally, when old Willett died, had assumed the business on his own hands. This was all that was known of his affairs. It was a common remark among some of the good people that he never had a word to say to a Christian soul, while others declared that though he spoke beautifully when he chose to, there was something wrong in his accent. A tidy man, too, they called him, all but for having that scandalous green pond alongside of his factory, which wasn't deep enough for an eel and was just a fever nest as sure as you live. His nationality was a great puzzle. The English name spoke plain enough for one side of his house, but of what manner of nation was his mother? If she'd been an American, he'd certainly have had high cheekbones and reddish skin. If a German, he would have known the language, and Squire Smith declared that he didn't. If French, and his having that frog pond made it seem likely, it would come out in his speech. No, there was nothing he could be but Dutch. And strangest of all, though the man always pricked up his ears when you talked of Holland, he didn't seem to know the first thing about the country when you put him to the point. Anyhow, as no letters ever came to him from his mother's family in Holland, and as nobody living had ever seen old Higgs, the family couldn't be anything much. Probably Thomas Higgs himself was no better than he should be.
for all he pretended to carry himself so straight. And for their parts, the gossips declared, they were not going to trouble their heads about him. Consequently, Thomas Higgs and his affairs were never failing subjects of discussion. Picture, then, the consternation among all the good people when it was announced by somebody who was there and ought to know that the postboy had that very morning handed Higgs a foreign-looking letter, and the man had turned as white as the wall, rushed to his factory, talked a bit with one of the head workmen, and without bidding a creature good-bye, was off bag and baggage before you could wink, ma'am. Mistress Scrubs, his landlady, was in deep affliction. The dear soul became quite out of breath while speaking of him.
"To leave lodgings in that sudden way, without never so much as a day's warning, which was what every woman who didn't wish to be trodden underfoot, which, thank heaven, wasn't her way, had a perfect right to expect. Yes, and a week's warning, now you mention it, and without even so much as saying, many thanks, Mistress Scrubs, for all past kindnesses, which were most numerous, though she said it who shouldn't say it. Leastwise, she wasn't never no kind of person to be looking for thanks every minute. It was really scandalous, though to be sure Mr. Higgs paid up everything to the last farthing, and it fairly brought tears to my eyes to see his dear empty boots lying there in the corner of his room, which alone showed trouble of mind, for he always stood em up straight as soldiers, though being half sold twice they hadn't, of course, been worth taking away.
Whereupon her dearest friend, Miss Scrumpkins, ran home to tell all about it, and as everybody knew the Scrumpkinses, a shining gossamer of news was soon woven from one end of the street to the other. An investigating committee met that evening at Mrs. Snigham's, sitting in secret session over her best china. Though invited only to a quiet tea, the amount of judicial business they transacted on the occasion was prodigious. The biscuits were actually cold before the committee had a chance to eat anything. There was so much to talk over, and it was so important that it should be firmly established that each member had always been certain sure that something extraordinary would be happening to that man yet, and that it was nearly 8 o'clock before Mrs. Snigham gave anybody a second cup. End of chapter. Chapter 47 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or The Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 47, Broad Sunshine. One snowy day in January, Lawrence Bookman went with his father to pay his respects to the Brinker family. Raff was resting after the labors of the day. Gretel, having filled and lighted his pipe, was brushing every speck of ash from the hearth. The dame was spinning, and Hans, perched upon a stool by the window, was diligently studying his lessons. It was a peaceful, happy household whose main excitement during the past week had been the looking forward to this possible visit from Thomas Higgs. As soon as the grand presentation was over, Dame Brinker insisted upon giving her guests some hot tea. It was enough to freeze anyone, she said, to be out in such crazy, blustering weather. While they were talking with her husband, she whispered to Gretel that the young gentleman's eyes and her boy's were certainly as much alike as four beans, to say nothing of a way they both had of looking as if they were stupid, and yet knew as much as a body's grandfather. Gretel was disappointed. She had looked forward to a tragic scene, such as Annie Bowman had often described to her from storybooks, and here was the gentleman who came so near being a murderer, who for 10 years had been wandering over the face of the earth, who believed himself deserted and scorned by his father, the very young gentleman who had fled from his country in such magnificent trouble, sitting by the fire just as pleasant and natural as could be. To be sure, his voice had trembled when he talked with her parents, and he had met his father's look with a bright kind of smile that would have suited a dragon-killer bringing the waters of perpetual youth to his king. But after all, he wasn't at all like the conquered hero in Annie's book. He did not say, lifting his arm toward heaven, "I hereby swear to be forever faithful to my home, my God, and my country," which would have been only right and proper under the circumstances. All things considered, Gretel was disappointed. Raff, however, was perfectly satisfied. The message was delivered. Dr. Bookman had his son safe and sound, and the poor lad had done nothing sinful after all, except in thinking that his father would have abandoned him for an accident. To be sure, the graceful stripling had become rather a heavy man. Raff had unconsciously hoped to clasp that same boyish hand again, but all things were changed to Raff, for that matter. So he pushed back every feeling but joy as he saw father and son sitting side by side at his hearthstone. Meantime, Hans was wholly occupied in the thought of Thomas Higgs's happiness in being able to be the Maester's assistant again, and Dame Brinker was sighing softly to herself, wishing that the lad's mother were alive to see him, such a fine young gentleman as he was, and wondering how Dr. Bookman could bear to see the silver watch getting so dull. He had worn it ever since Raff handed it over, that was evident. What had he done with the gold one he used to wear? The light was shining full upon Dr. Bookman's face. How contented he looked! How much younger and brighter than formerly! The hard lines were quite melting away. He was laughing as he said to the father, "Am I not a happy man, Raff Brinker? My son will sell out his factory this month and open a warehouse in Amsterdam. I shall have all my spectacle cases for nothing." Hans started from his reverie.
"A warehouse, mynheer? And will Thomas Higgs, I mean, is your son not to be your assistant again?"
A shade passed over the maester's face, but he brightened with an effort as he replied, "Oh, no, Lawrence has had quite enough of that. He wishes to be a merchant." Hans appeared so surprised and disappointed that his friend asked good-naturedly, "Why so silent, boy? Is it any disgrace to be a merchant?"
Not a disgrace, mynheer," stammered Hans, "but..."
"But what?"
"Why, the other calling is so much better," answered Hans, "so much nobler. I think, mynheer," he added with enthusiasm, "that to be a surgeon, to cure the sick and crippled, to save human life, to be able to do what you have done for my father, is the grandest thing on earth."
The doctor was regarding him sternly. Hans felt rebuked. His cheeks were flushed. Hot tears were gathering under his lashes. "It is an ugly business, boy, this surgery," said the doctor, still frowning at Hans. "It requires great patience, self-denial, and perseverance."
"I am sure that it does," cried Hans. "It calls for wisdom, too, and a reverence for God's work. Ah, mynheer, it may have its trials and drawbacks, but you do not mean what you say. It is great and noble, not ugly. Pardon me, mynheer. It is not for me to speak so boldly."
Dr. Bookman was evidently displeased. He turned his back on the boy and conferred aside with Lorenz. Meanwhile, the dame scowled a terrible warning at Hans. These great people, she knew well enough, never liked to hear poor folk speak up so pertly. The maester turned around. "How old are you, Hans Brinker?"
15, mynheer," was the startled reply.
"Would you like to become a physician?"
"Yes, mynheer," answered Hans, quivering with excitement.
"Would you be willing, with your parents' consent, to devote yourself to study, to go to the university, and in time be a student in my office?"
"Yes, mynheer."
"You would not grow restless, think you, and change your mind just as I had set my heart upon preparing you to be my successor?" Hans's eyes flashed. "No, mynheer, I would not change."
"You may believe him there," cried the dame, who could remain quiet no longer. "Hans is like a rock when once he decides. And as for study, mynheer, the child has almost grown fast to his books of late. He can jumble off Latin already, like any priest."
The doctor smiled. "Well, Hans, I see nothing to prevent us from carrying out this plan, if your father agrees."
"Ahem," said Raff, too proud of his boy to be very meek. "The fact is, mynheer, I prefer an active out-of-door life myself. But if the lad's inclined to study for a maester, and he'd have the benefit of your good word to push him on in the world, it's all one to me. The money's all that's wanting, but it mightn't be long with two strong pair of arms to earn it before we—"
"Tut, tut," interrupted the doctor. "If I take your right-hand man away, I must pay the cost, and glad enough will I be to do it. It will be like having two sons, eh, Lawrence? One a merchant and the other a surgeon. I shall be the happiest man in Holland. Come to me in the morning, Hans, and we will arrange matters at once."
Hans bowed assent. He dared not trust himself to speak.
"And Brinker," continued the doctor, "my son Lawrence will need a trusty, ready man like you when he opens his warehouse in Amsterdam. Someone to oversee matters, and see that the lazy clowns round about the place do their duty. Someone to—" "Oh, why don't you tell him yourself, you rascal?" This last was addressed to the son, and did not sound half as fierce as it looks in print. The rascal and Raff soon understood each other perfectly. "I'm loath to leave the dykes," said the latter, after they had talked together a while. "But it is such a good offer, mynheer. I'd be robbing my family if I let it go past me."
Take a long look at Hans, as he sits there staring gratefully at the maester, for you shall not see him again for many years. And Gretel, ah, what a vista of puzzling work suddenly opens before her! Yes, for dear Hans's sake she will study now. If he really is to be a maester, his sister must not shame his greatness. How faithfully those glancing eyes shall yet seek for the jewels that lie hidden in rocky schoolbooks, and how they shall yet brighten and droop at the coming of one whom she knows of now only as the boy who wore a red cap on that wonderful day when she found the silver skates in her apron. But the doctor and Lawrence are going. Dame Brinker is making her best curtsy. Raff stands beside her, looking every inch a man as he grasps the maester's hand. Through the open cottage door we can look out upon the level Dutch landscape, all alive with the falling snow. End of chapter.
Chapter 48 of Hans Brinker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This recording is by Mark Smith of Simpsonville, South Carolina. Hans Brinker, or the Silver Skates, by Mary Mapes Dodge. Chapter 48. Conclusion. Our story is nearly told. Time passes in Holland just as surely and steadily as here. In that respect, no country is odd. To the Brinker family it has brought great changes. Hans has spent the years faithfully and profitably, conquering obstacles as they arose and pursuing one object with all the energy of his nature. If often the way has been rugged, his resolution has never failed. Sometimes he echoes, with his good friend, the words said long ago in that little cottage near Brook. Surgery is an ugly business, but always in his heart of hearts lingers the echo of those truer words. It is great and noble. It awakes a reverence for God's work. Were you in Amsterdam today, you might see the famous Dr. Brinker, riding in his grand coach to visit his patients. Or, it might be, you would see him skating with his own boys and girls upon the frozen canal. For Annie Bowman, the beautiful, frank-hearted peasant girl, you would inquire in vain. But Annie Brinker, the Frau of the great physician, is very like her. Only, as Hans says, she is even lovelier, wiser, more like a fairy godmother than ever. Peter Van Holp also is a married man. I could have told you before that he and Hilda would join hands and glide through life together, just as years ago they skimmed side by side over the frozen sunlit river. At one time I came near hinting that Katrinka and Carl would join hands. It is fortunate that the report was not started, for Katrinka changed her mind and is single to this day. The lady is not quite so merry as formerly, and, I grieve to say, some of the tinkling bells are out of tune. But she is the life of her social circle still. I wish she would be in earnest, just for a little while, but no, it is not in her nature. Her cares and sorrows do nothing more than disturb the tinkling. They never waken any deeper music. Richie's soul has been stirred to its depths during these long years. Her history would tell how seed carelessly sown is sometimes reaped in anguish, and how a golden harvest may follow a painful planting. If I mistake not, you may be able to read the written record before long, that is, if you are familiar with the Dutch language, in the witty but earnest author whose words are welcome to this day in thousands of Holland homes. Few could recognize the haughty, flippant Richie, who scoffed at little Gretel. Lambert van Monen and Ludwig van Holp are good Christian men, and, what is more easily to be seen at a glance, thriving citizens. Both are dwellers in Amsterdam, but one clings to the old city of that name, and the other is a pilgrim to the new. Van Monen's present home is not far from Central Park, and he says, if the New Yorkers do their duty, the park will in time equal his beautiful Bosch near The Hague. He often thinks of the Katrinka of his boyhood, but he is glad now that Katrinka, the woman, sent him away, though it seemed at the time his darkest hour. Ben's sister Jenny has made him very happy, happier than he could have been with anyone else in the wide world. Carl Schummel has had a hard life. His father met with reverses in business, and as Carl had not many warm friends, and above all, was not sustained by noble principles, he has been tossed about by fortune's battledore, until his gayest feathers are nearly all knocked off. He is a bookkeeper in the thriving Amsterdam house of Bookman and Schimmelpenninck. Wustenwalbert, the junior partner, treats him kindly, and he in turn is very respectful to the monkey with a long name for a tail. Of all our group of Holland friends, Jacob Poot is the only one who has passed away. Good-natured, true-hearted, and unselfish to the last, he is mourned now as heartily as he was loved and laughed at while on earth. He grew to be very thin before he died, thinner than Benjamin Dobbs, who is now portliest among the portly. Ralph Brinker and his Vrouw have been living comfortably in Amsterdam for many years, a faithful, happy pair, as simple and straightforward in their good fortune as they were patient and trustful in darker days. They have a zomerhuis near the old cottage, and thither they often repair with their children and grandchildren, on the pleasant summer afternoons when the pond lilies rear their queenly heads above the water. The story of Hans Brinker would be but half told if we did not leave him with Gretel standing near. Dear, quick, patient little Gretel! What is she now? Ask old Dr. Bookman. He will declare that she is the finest singer, the loveliest woman in Amsterdam. Ask Hans and Annie, and they will assure you that she is the dearest sister ever known. Ask her husband. He will tell you that she is the brightest, sweetest little wife in Holland. Ask Dame Brinker and Raff. Their eyes will glisten with joyous tears. Ask the poor, and the air will be filled with blessings. But lest you forget a tiny form trembling and sobbing on the mound before the Brinker cottage, ask the Van Glecks. They will never weary of telling of the darling little girl who won the silver skates. End of chapter, end of book. Thank you for listening.